Blog Talk Radio.
Allegheny the 5th Pope, 1431, 1503. Demarcation Bull. Grand Spain possession of the land discovered by Columbus. The doctrine of discovery became the basis of all European claims. So who is the Pope? The Pope is the leader of the church. And he gonna write an edict, a papist bull, saying that it's okay to enslave African people? Because what? Because they are not Christians?
The devil is a lie, trying to hold me down. Heaven is my cry, hit different levels when I'm high. Got a gold body and an older soul. Use a nobody with no control. So when the sun goes down in a night show, me and my girl see this world like a light show. So holla fan, cause she got a man. Sophia, Nokia, got me looking at you like a hologram. I got snake heads with body armor. I break bread and die for karma. I get killed for fun to come back to life. I got killed by a gun, then healed by the sun. Cause I live by the nuns and I act like Christ. I am higher. I think on drugs, just the vampires that drink on blood. I've been to hell and back. Now my cells live forever like Henrietta Lacks. Track.
I told him when he talks about the one becomes the many and the many becomes the one, if we go back to the eukaryotic cell, which is a society of bacteria that formed the first single cell. That first single cell that evolved duplicated itself and created multiple cells. So what I'm saying is that this right here is the process of what, how, and what everything became from one. And the Comedians and the Africans clearly said that, yo. Everything that the Africans talked about was based off evolution. You know, it was the science that I came to my conclusion that world history is African history. Experiencing the pyramid and experiencing the beautiful beaches in Senegal, Gambia, being a Bantu farmer, you know, dealing with agriculture.
I always contend that we're super niggas. What I mean is we had the ability to mutate based off of our environment. Imagine this, the blueprint of humanity is an African before the word Africa. Alright? Blueprint. And the planet we live on is a sun planet. That's why you hear us call us the children of the sun. You're designed to live on a sun planet. So we super niggas. We can turn, we can become Asians, we can become pale skinned. We can do whatever it needs to take to have the next generation because we super niggas.
I rap like a killer in Paris. I act like a nigga about to turn into a cat like Thriller. My wife's lifespan, it's like a thousand cycles. I'm half man, half Christ, a thousand Michaels. Magic gloves and socks, my magic's hot. That's how I move, walk over these magic rocks. I heal kids when they can't, my essence. Touch stars, grown folks faint in my presence. They feel the touch of God.
I want your soul, I want your life, I want the land, it is worth the wait.
in my hands at the pearly gates. I made up words, I made up numbers, I cast spells that mankind's under. I don't talk and I don't speak, I don't think thoughts, nigga, don't think me. I don't walk cause I got no feet, I'm out of mind in my outer body. Got a lunar face and a lunar body, I illuminate like Illuminati. When night clears, appear day stars, my radar, detect agar, collect data, using lasers. I'm light years beyond quasars.
Black African Power. Welcome to the Rebirth of the African Civilization Show, the home of the Amara Squad, a well-organized lie. Defeats a disorganized truth.
Peace to you, brother. Shout to him, Black African Power. What's good?
Hey, yo, I'm MJ, MJ, MK Ultra. Snakehead on my head. Vulture. I make beds till I break bread with Oprah. I'm over Cobra, stay ahead of culture. They make new slaves, I'ma make new niggas. And on paydays, I'ma make new figures. Fuck Bill Gates, I dance with Medusa. And the dance bring me cake like a master the Musa. In this world, I'm a floss and my brand new speakers. Your girl love my voice and my band two features. King Tut coughing, dreams of assaulting. Scene is so potent, my seeds born talking. And tongues never spoken, scripts never written. I called after hitting. One like Amen, the unlettered prophet that profits from ramen. The flow been knowledge, I open college and I use sign language that is so symbolic. Science we be reading, studying math. Artifacts from Egypt, studied the craft. Word up. Yo, I'm just going off the vibe, hand beating the drum. Do my skin love God, cause it's eating the sun. I capture light, glowing in my afterlife with God's trust. I turn stars into stardust, advancing fire. Chanting around dancing fire with smoke from plants enhancing higher. Inhale, winds fell and go intel. Then dwell, left you in a trend and a spell. I could have been in the trench with the 12. Adjust that. All I need is a slug in the Mac. When I squeeze, my enemies bleed. Please take the energy away and let it freeze. Like being God made it. That's the worst thing. That's to be a reincarnated Abdullah slash Duga, half Buddha, the black Buddha. Design my mind like a black computer with an internet. Color me, act like you entering college. I got degrees while traveling through black holes. Crystallized in the physical of black souls. On earth in the sun, reflecting the universe. Priceless, hard like devices. Resurrect the God like ISIS. Righteous, all hell Osiris. Something in hell of pious. I see far rising over the horizon. In the sun is setting on the runway. And on Sunday, the flesh do sun ray. Knowing one day I'll be dressed in the sun ray. Feel my double, the stream move jet fast. I beamed up using King Tut's death mask. And on the rise through the eyes, I hate proof. I learned to do magic that's higher than they do. Now they wanna know, yo, is oh, yo, is he good? I stay on the low road with the priesthood. Yo. This goes out. Physical, yo. I'm with y'all.
y'all. Goes out to all those who will come after me, y'all. Wise up and rise up. Y'all think of that. Ashe to the creative powers of the universe. Oh, chap. To the Most High, giving me this inspiration. Yo, it's that 2012 music, yo. You got a vibe to it, yo. It's that anthem, yo.
Black African Power. Welcome to the Rebirth of the African Civilization Show, the home of the Amun Ra Squad. What's good? What's happening? A well-organized lie. It's a disorganized truth every time. Ooh-wee! Y'all already know what it is. We're here doing what we're supposed to do. Because we're going to do what the hell we're supposed to do. Because that's how we doing it. Amun Ra Squad up. Man, we had a powerful show this afternoon on the Google Hangout. Y'all got to check us out on Sundays. Me and the sister, Dr. Mayat, we're going to be rocking that Sunday school class. What they should have taught you before you went to church. Y'all can go check that out on the YouTube. Make sure y'all go ahead and sign into the website. We'll be answering questions in the website, right? I'm pretty sure it's working right. Man, it's a good day. Y'all should have caught that show. Took a lot of energy to do, but it was right there. Standard, that class right there is for the beginners. And I'm going to let y'all know, the way we have been building communities clearly show we are still beginners. We're acting like boys and girls because boys and girls always need people to bring resources to them, always need people to give them things. That's a boy. That's a girl. A man and a woman makes their own way in the natural world, always operating from a position of power. And if they can't, they sure as hell die trying. Are you trying hard enough? Well, what we like to say, if you're trying, you're losing. Because winners win and losers try. Boy, and it's all good what we're dealing with today. We got the young lion, bold to be coming in, talking about Ethiopia and Christianity. Hell, y'all already know how I'm feeling when I hear that word. My antennas go up. My earplugs go in. Because I already know it ain't but so much you can prove when you talk about Christianity. Call it fakeianity. Boy, it's going to be interesting. I want to hear the take on it from the young brother. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I mean, you know, I got in the works. I got the historical origin of Christianity. I got E.A. Wallace Bird, the Book of Mysteries of the Heaven and Earth, and other works, okay? Man, what else we got here? We got the African origin of the three major religions. Great, open up the line real quick. Before I open the line, I come right in with this one, right off the bat, so we can establish what's really going on around here. On page 77 on the African Origin of Christianity by the brother Shigante Dias, the great master teacher, he clearly says, approximately 65 years after Cenerentia rebellion in 115 CE, and sometime before July 180 CE, Christianity was introduced into Northwest Africa. I'm going to say it again. Approximately 65 years after Clarentia Rebellion, let me spell that because I can't even say it right, C-Y-R-E-N-A-I-C-A, Rebellion, in 115 CE, and sometime before July 180 CE, Christianity was introduced into North Africa. Do you know how late that is in African history? And sometimes before July 180 CE, Christianity was introduced into North Africa. The date is approximately true because there was never any mention of Christians there before in any of the records of the Roman imperial government that colonized the area. The first mention of Christianity came about with the martyrdom of many of their numbers on the 17th of July, 180 CE. There is no record given the exact number of the original group either, only of those tried and found guilty of committing Christian acts against the Roman state. So y'all already know that time the Romans was calling them Christians atheists. Man, that's funny, right? That's on page 77. I ain't say the atheist part of the book, yo. Page 78. This was some part. This is probably the part a lot of people are waiting for. Y'all can jump up from chair and shit. Let me see. It must be remembered that the Christians of Carthage were indigenous Africans brought in from the neighboring state called Numidia as slaves for the Roman imperialists who were ruling Carthage and other parts of northern Africa at the time. It is also to be noted that amongst these earliest of Christian slaves, every color were Petria, brother, and the same Felicia mentioned before, of whom it was said her ordeal caused the premature birth of her only child a few hours previous to her death as the martyr for Jesus Christ. All right, interesting. Y'all know what it is. She ended up being a martyr, killed her. Y'all can figure out if she was African or not. Who the hell knows? So, Jetty, your line is open. Black African Power.
And Black Africa Power, Unc. Peace. Hold tight. He's ready to get in. See what's going on with this Christianity Ethiopia. You know what I mean? Ready to get down. Peace.
Rude Raw. Hello?
Hey, Lion.
What's up?
Lion.
Yeah, what's up with it?
What's up? What happened to Daddy, man? Black, but what happened to Daddy?
Oh, no. He was just on. He was talking, and I think it was like a silence delay.
Oh, man, he's supposed to kept rapping. God damn. Excuse my language, man. What's good, brother? Go ahead and rock real quick, yo. I'm taking care of Mercy with, Sarnetta, man. Hold on. Let me get Chris, what's good? Black African Power, brother. Chris. He ain't saying nothing, man. 757.
Yeah, Black African Power. What's up,
Black African
Young
Power,
Lion? What's going on?
Hey, go.
Yeah, I'm gonna
rock. Go. Yo, I'm gonna squad up. Your line yeah, over yo. Here, I got to take first. Yeah, y'all rock out, man. Hold on.
Don't let the cat get y'all tongue, yo. It's three of y'all on the phone, man.
What's up, Sam? And Black African Power. I'm gonna rock squad up. Team Osiris. What down?
Yeah, Team Osiris. Team Osiris in the building. The Mavericks of science. You know what I'm saying? The people who can read anything and to get the moral understanding out of it and know it's all just literature, art. You know what I mean? And they got a deeper meaning to it. You know what I'm saying? You can put any mask or face you want to. We can make up our own. We can make up our own stories. You know what I'm saying? But
oh yeah.
But I, you know what I'm saying, what I like to get into is first, you know what I'm saying, before you even have to deal with the Christianity in Ethiopia, you have to deal with the, you know what I'm saying, the religious fusion in ancient Egypt, you know what I'm saying, during the early Hellenic time when Alexander took over. You know what I'm saying, because you got, you know what I'm saying, at first, you know what I'm saying, I got this article, you know what I'm saying, that's called Religious Syncretism. You know what I'm saying? At first glance, the Egyptian pantheon presents a bewildering array of gods, having little in common with the Christian god man. But properly understood, many Egyptian deities were city or regional variations on a theme. Gods whose fortunes rose or fell with the outcome of human power struggles and dynastic change. Triumph priests merged useful aspects of fallen rivals deities with their own favorite god. This process of absorption, assimilation, and adoption continued throughout Greek, Roman, and Christian eras. Though the basic Christ legend was formulated by apostate Jews, you know what I'm saying, who joined these, you know, who later joined Greek and, you know what I'm saying, Greek and Egyptian mystery schools, you know what I'm saying, that were established after the conquest of Alexander, and they ran the taxation of the temples, you know what I'm saying, all the places that they conquered in Asia and places in Africa. But with their expectation of conquering Messiah, a pagan converse with the fables of dying reborn sun gods, Egypt provided Christianity with ideas not found in the Old Testament. Immorality of the soul, judgment of the dead, return and punishment and reunion God, the ancient religion of Egypt infused the nascent faith of Christ with much of its creed. So, you know what I'm saying? So this lays up, you know what I'm saying, this establishment between the Egyptians and the Hellenists, you know what I'm saying, when they took over, Alexander took over, you know what I'm saying, because, you know, by then, you know what I'm saying, the game was over, you know what I'm saying, the Hellenist culture, that played a big impact on the last, you know what I'm saying, on the late BC century in between the first AD century. So, you know what I'm saying, so this Hellenic boom, you know what I'm saying, all across Mesopotamia, North Africa, you know what I'm saying, this religion fusion is the progenitor of what, you know what I'm saying, what happened with the Christianity in Ethiopia, you know what I'm saying, because the whole Mediterranean trade was controlled by Hellenists. I mean, it left a lot of Africans or different tribes, you know what I'm saying, in the sub-Saharan African port, you know what I'm saying, without exports or their control, you know, so you had to go through other people, you know what I mean, you had to, use, you know what I'm saying, you have to, you know what I'm saying, ally yourself with people to, you know what I'm saying, to sell your goods and feed your people and feed your kingdom. You know what I'm saying? It's like chess. You know, so you just can't do stuff recklessly. You gotta think, you know what I'm saying, strategically to survive. Hello?
Yeah, we here.
Y'all out there?
We here. Yeah.
Okay, let me get into actually the history of
Let's get into to get people let people understand how the Abyssinians got Christianity from the Syrians and what was going on with the markets, you know, from King Azana, and why was the reason that they did it?
Okay. Well, the reason why they did it was that during the time, you know what I'm saying, you know, after the destruction of Demont, you know what I'm saying, after Demont fell economically, and you know what I'm saying, in that area, in that Eritrean area, all the little chieftains separated into individual chieftains or rival chieftains all throughout Eritrea and all throughout Arabia, even the Sabian capital separated from the capitals in Eritrea. But they all, you know what I'm saying, they all still, you know what I'm saying, traded with each other and worked with each other, you know what I mean? So the Aksumite Empire, you know what I'm saying, what they had over the other empires, you know what I'm saying, because the last capital was Yihai. It was another sacred kingdom named Yihai. But Aksum ended up being the most powerful one because they became more richer because they sent out people to actually learn Greek, you know what I'm saying, and learn different languages, you know what I'm saying, so they can communicate and trade with different people, different markets. You know what I'm saying? Everybody was up the game. It was a competition. You know what I'm saying? You had, you know, because this was like a sort of intermediate period, you know what I'm saying, during the time of these, you know what I'm saying, during that time, like the late BC, probably around 600 BC, around that time. But leading up to that, you know what I'm saying, the Aksumites knew Greek, you know what I'm saying, and Greek at the time, or the Hellenist time, was the language of commerce, the language of trade. And they controlled everything. They had the most trade, owned the most trade ports, or had the most foothold on trade ports. So, you get you to, you know what I'm saying, the life of Azana. You know what I'm saying? Azana was...
So basically, the Abyssinians, it wasn't like they were complete sore losers and someone forced it or shoved it down their throat. A few of these brothers just chose to deal with it for commerce, for networking, for money. Because at this time period, the Syrians or the Byzantine Empire controlled the resources.
Yes. Right? I mean, yes. Okay. Even though... You know what I'm saying? The Eritrean area was a main trading center. It was right foot in the middle of major trade systems between the Indian spice trade. You know what I'm saying? They had their own myrrh and French trade with incense. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what a lot of those temples and, you know, some preschools, you know, they had demand in frankincense. You know what I'm saying? Frankincense and incense. So they believe, you know what I'm saying, even from back in Ethiopian time, they believe when you light up natural incense, you smell in the natural essences of nature, or they had, they symbolically said that this was the scent of the deity of their temple. You know what I mean? And they also just needed an export. It was either you was going to die or sit there like a sitting duck, or you going to get into business and see what's going on in the world. And take advantage of that.
So would it be safe to say that our first Coptic priests who converted into Christianity with these Syrians were they? I'm not going to say atheists, but they really didn't take it literal, like they gave it to the citizens. It was all business.
It was all business because you had Christian merchants, Buddhists, different Jew sects. Different Christian sects all throughout Ethiopia, but they formed their own. They formed, you know what I'm saying, when Izana came, you know what I'm saying, Izana was a child, You know what I'm saying? Zana was a child, and also Prometheus was a young boy when he came to Ethiopia, because they was on their way from Syria, from Tyre, they was on their way to India to trade. You know what I'm saying? India was a big trading place too. You know, they ran the spice trade. You know what I'm saying? So on their way to India, they ship crashed at Adulis on that's like the west. The eastern shoreline of Eritrea, right there on the Red Sea, on the coast of the Red Sea. So their ship crashed, and they was brought up to the king of Aksum. You know what I'm saying? The elders, you know what I'm saying? The adults on the boat all died off, but Prometheus and his brother survived, and they was brought up to the court of the king of Aksum. You know what I'm saying? And the king of Aksum at the time, Ili Amida. You know what I'm saying? Izana's father made them his servants. You know what I'm saying? And they taught him. You know, so they taught him in his way. But they was already learned and taught in Christianity. But like when you were serving in Ethiopia, you still was able to roam around the kingdom and shit like that. And he spoke. You know, so spoke to the different Christian merchants and stuff like that. That's how he really stayed in tune with Christianity. You know what I'm saying? Talking to the people, the merchants of the trade ports, and that was his idea. You know what I'm saying? He brought that, and he, you know what I'm saying? They really saved his ass, you know what I'm saying? And he brought that to the court of Elamita, you know what I'm saying? And he thought it was a good idea to partnership with, you know what I'm saying, with the people of the Mediterranean for export trade routes so they can establish an empire, you know what I'm saying? Or extend their empire.
Hey, Jetty, you still on?
Yeah, I'm right here.
Oh, Samoa to be, brother. What's good?
Peace, family, peace. Yeah, make a quick comment. Peace to everybody. Peace to your
Black African Power, fellas.
All right. Yeah, also, we also have to account the Mediterranean Sea Trade, okay, in which many in East and North Africa wanted to enter into. Because, again, with the Mediterranean Sea Trade, you have trade between North Africa, Europe, mm-hmm. as well as Western Asia. So you have all those points. And, again, if you want to broaden your trade horizons, then, okay, so you're in the Red Sea trade, but then if you go to the Mediterranean Sea Trade, then that takes your import-export to a whole nother level. And if one of the advantages of entering into that trade is going into the religious practices of those who control the trade, then if your objective is to enter into that, then some people look at it as then it'd be advantageous to practice the same religion. For relatability, this is the same phenomenon that we see with the empires in the West, Ghana, Mali, and Songhai. Where some of the ruling classes began to utilize Islam in order for relatability, because again they wanted to enter into the trade, because again at the time Islam took a foothold, so now you want to be able to relate with those who have political and economic power. Same thing what happens today. For example, let's say Japanese and Asians, and even our African brothers and sisters, et cetera, they'll wear French suits, European type suits and ties, et cetera, in order to enter into the trade relations, political relationships, and economic relationships. So,
let me throw this in here real fast. Wallace E. Burge. Actually, the book is dealing with, suggest y'all get that, man. It's the Book of the Mysteries, right, of the heavens and the earth. All right? It's Ethiopian. It's written in Ethiopian script. In other words, by Bakala Mikael. All right? Now, see the white boy got to say on the matter, man. Interesting. It say, before the three religions of the book began their struggle for the soul of Ethiopia. Let's go right down to the reference. Shit.
Ethiopia is the name of the country because I got a thing there. The country in my heart, the language of the majority of the people, because it is an official name, it is used here in preference to the popular but unofficial alternative of Abyssinia, which is derived from the Arabic El Habasha. All right, now, it says, before the three religions of the book began their struggle for the soul of Ethiopia. Well, that's funny that we see once again, you got these religions vying for the souls of African people. I mean, white boys start off right there. They say, pagan kings, see, a nigga got to be a pagan, built the city of Aksum as their capital, right? Their gods have gone. Gods ain't went no damn where. But the towering granite obelisk they placed in front of the vanished temples remain. Yep, we can go there to this day and see it. It's a cap with emblems of the sun and the moon. The obelisk stands as symbolic bridges between earth and the sky, solid witnesses to the continuing fascination with the relationship between the heavens and the earth that has been a constant and a powerful element of Ethiopian spirituality. See, I'm that guy that want to say the hell of them three religions. And I like to go back to how it was before the Christianity, before the Islam and the Judaism, because they had a system in place. Now, I'm feeling what the brother's talking about. He's trying to give you a view on he's giving some in-betweens on business and the reality. Like, the shit get real. Like, you can say you don't want to be this, you don't be that, but you got to feed your people and you got to trade. The Muslims routinely made African kings. You just got to, that's how you do business. I mean, you want to get deal with the trade routes and the trade and the commerce, man. You know, you got to deal with what it is. So that's the reality situation, and we don't talk about that too often, about what situation they was placed in. But since I'm recognized what situation they was placed in, right, that African kings would even have to suggest that they would need to be Christians to deal with the thing, it's some bullshit on its own. But it's a real live situation that I think the brother is showing us how we navigated through that. All right? So that's important. Okay? Now, let me move on. Okay? Now, all right, we're talking about just as Judaism first reached Ethiopia, the next phase from Ethiopia, so did Christianity. Its establishment as the official and ultimate dominant religion of the country was due, however, to activities of Greek Christians early in the 4th century A.D., according to legendary historian, supported by patriot texts, and more recently discovered inscriptions at Aksum. The Aksum king Uzana was converted by Prometheus and Abydias, the sons of a Greek scholar from Turin, who had traveled to Ethiopia. These two missionaries, right?
Yeah.
Not only spread the new faith, hold on, brother, but also educated Uzana and acted as a regent during his youth. This brought official blessing upon Christianity. And about 330, Prometheus went to Alexandria, where Athenius, the great champion of the Christian orthodoxy, consecrated him as a bishop, gave him the title of Abba, our father, and confirmed him as the patriarch of the Ethiopian church. Prometheus then returned to Ethiopia, and from this time on, the country can be considered effectively a Christian nation. Other troubles, however, laid ahead. Go ahead, brother, you were saying something.
No, you already hit it. You already said he was a child. You know what I'm saying? They sent his ass to the patriarch. You know what I'm saying? Made him learn. You know what I'm saying? And bring back the information. You know what I'm saying? And even then, you had a big debate between the Malkites and the people of the Coptic, or you know, some Orthodox people, the monophysites. You know what I'm saying? Because the Malkites, they wanted to separate the nature of the deity or the logos and make it more than what it really was, you know what I'm saying, saying that the divinity of Christ was separated from the character, but the Coptic or the Orthodox, they wanted to just keep it realistic and symbolic, with saying that it's the same thing with human nature, the human nature and the divine nature is one. And we all the same.
Mm. Mm. All right, watch this. Let me kind of support you in the same book. Watch this. Because, see, the thing that's funny is you'll see the Africans back then right now, we be saying we Christians, but we don't really be that doing that for real. I promise you. Watch this. It's a Ethiopia. May have been Christians, but what kind of Christians? During the 4th and 5th century, the major division within Christianity concerned the theological definition of the person of Christ. To modern observers, obscure philosophical distinctions in the domestic theology seem to be a little or no particular concern, but in the early church, they were matters of enormous importance, generating controversy and passions that shook the empire as well as souls. The first of these controversies was a violent dispute as to the divinity of Christ. It is centered on the teachings of Arius, 250 to 336, who denied the incarnated Christ was divine. There was major political ramifications to this dispute, in that the Western and Eastern Roman empires supported opposing views, but Prometheus, who might have been expected to lean towards the east, followed the lead of Athenius, who was a great and ultimate successful opponent of Arius, and Ethiopia remained in the Orthodox camp. A century later, it would leave it. Mm. Well, so we see the Ethiopians were siding with Arius, and Athenius sided with Arius. And so we know that they were saying, hold up, man, ain't no man, no goddamn creator of the universe, you tripping. Because that was basically what Arius was saying. He's like, come on, y'all, man, Christ was created, yo, stop it. All right? Mm-hmm. So, okay, so we see that. Go ahead, bro.
Because then even in their version, the Ethiopian version, the Ethiopian Tewodjo's church, they in their book, it say Christ was born in Ethiopia, in a cave in Ethiopia. You know, so they wrote it their own way. They gave it their own, they used to update the shit. Like when they was going against the Ottoman Empire, you know, so when I went to Ethiopia in one of the stone rock churches, you could see how usually they had the Jews kneeling up Christ, or either they had Romans kneeling up Christ, whoever, you know, to whoever the story belonged to. During this time, the Christians had, I mean, the Ethiopians had the Ottoman Empire, like white Ottoman Empire cat nailing up the black Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Wow. Let me see what's going on here. Let me take a quick call, right? And then I want to put some documentation here, right? And I want to talk about some of the things that's kind of troubling with me with the Christianity part. You want to add something to that, Chris? Yeah, Chris. How about you and Gozy?
Y'all getting it in, brother.
Y'all going. Shut up. All right, bro. All right. 317, your line is open. I'm Raw Squad up.
Yeah, what up? I'm Raw Squad.
What's good, bro? How you doing?
Peace to Team Osiris. What's happening? Yeah, this brother Aero, man. I never quite, you know, told y'all my name, man. You know, I'm here every Thursday and Sunday, bro.
Hey, man, appreciate that, brother. How you doing, Aero?
I'm doing all right, man. You know, I hope everybody's doing the same, bro. But no, I'm here for the information, bro. I just want to make sure I get cut off, man. Y'all go ahead and get it in, bro.
All right, brother. Appreciate your support, man.
Thank you, bro.
All right. 734, your line is open. Black African Power. 734. I'm going to put you back on.
Peace to the squad. What's going on?
What's going on, brother?
Hello?
What's up, brother?
Peace, brother.
Hey, what's good? What's good, man? Peace to the squad.
Mr. Lee, Nazir Lee.
Hey, yeah, I'm here to body bag you niggas. I ain't here to play.
Oh, wow. Good God Almighty.
What you got, Nazir?
Well, I mean, from my understanding, at the beginning of the show, you had a brother that was getting ready to go in on Ethiopia and Christianity. So I didn't want to undercut that. But, you know, I'm coming from the, I guess, what you guys would call Judaism, you know what I mean, but what I call Judean culture. So I'm coming from that perspective. But I have a couple of topics, man, that's touching on last week. So, you know, when you want to get it in on that, we can. Tilly and I just listen in.
Yeah, we'll hold you. We'll bag you up. We got you. Finish your ass off with that pseudo shit you talking. We got you. The line opens for Jenny.
All right.
You're making us a mystery. I'm gonna make you. I'm gonna give you a Pulitzer surprise, yo. You can get that with the Novel, nigga. Well, you be coming up with some shit, boy. Won't give us no damn sources though, boy. I tell you, god dang.
I got something for you this week.
He got his own Bible. He got his own Bible.
He got his own. All right, man. In the chat, man, we put some documentation to add to this conversation. That's what the hell we do around here. I'm the Rock Squad, man. All right. Damn. Okay. In the chat room, got the document, man. It's a PDF. It's Ethiopia in the Mediterranean world in late antiquity. The Garma Gospel in context. Right? Now, what is the Garma Gospel? First of all, right, research has uncovered, right, Lost African School of Painting. They say analysts of illustrated gospel suggest that the first Christian manuscript came from Ethiopia. Yeah, yo, because you know how we do shit, man.
They were telling that shit.
And so what I'm going to show you is, right, now this kind of bothers me, but it is what it is, but the first artistic expression, you know what I'm saying, other gospels, and the oldest is in Ethiopia, okay? It says evidence has emerged that for the previously unknown school of painting in the sub-Saharan Africa, that may have been responsible for the earliest Christian painting in manuscripts. New research suggests that the illustrations in the two Ethiopian gospels dating back to 1,500 years were painted in the ancient kingdom of Aksum and not in the Middle East, as previously believed. They say these illustrations, which include a set of evangelists, are evidence of the Aksumite school of painting, says Jock Mercer, a specialist in Ethiopian art at the Central National de la Recherche Scientifique in Paris. Aksum lies in present-day Eritrea and northern Ethiopia. If Mercer's theory is correct, it sheds new light on the development of early Christian art. And I put it in the chat room. All right, one of the oldest pictures they show on here. This is very, very important. All right, boom. Y'all can look at it. But the thing that troubles me is look at the figurine. Look at the figure. They're not painting the African. Right? They're painting blue eyes and it's just. But I'm really trying to really understand this. What is this picture really telling us though? You see the helios, you see the sun behind the person's head, right? What are they really trying? What is the message they're giving us? You would think that they would paint their patrons and their gods black, right? Maybe they were trying to leave us a message here. It's just very, very interesting, man. Maybe they was leaving us a message because they ain't that damn crazy. You know, we got to twist it and turn it and look a lot of different ways. This is one of the oldest depictions. But go ahead, brother.
I was gonna say, like with the business aspect, shit. The Izana on the Izana song, you know, what I'm saying he was writing tribute. You know, what I'm saying just he was just business. He was writing tribute to like the Greek deity, their traditional deities, the new Christian type deities. And then when you know you had a time because during the time of the Byzantine Empire, the Byzantine Empire had split up. You know what I'm saying? It became the Western Rome and Eastern Rome. You know what I'm saying? The Akhmites, you could find the Akhmite coins. They were doing business with the Western part of Rome, too. Even when they were split up, you know what I'm saying? They were their own power because Akhmite Empire was a rival or a contemporary empire with the empires of Rome, the Persian Empire, and the Chinese Empire, and the Indian empires at the time.
So would we consider this as some of the earliest stages of what we might call the Ma'afa, great and utter destruction, that where the image of the European starts to become used as the deity, and it enters into the Central East African heart of a continent, and then spreads from there. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Of course, it already entered into Kemet, but then it swings around, goes into Ethiopia, and then later on goes into what we're calling Nubia as well.
Yeah, you are, because right after Phoenicians, all the other Abunas that were sent to Ethiopia was Coptic Semitic priests. I mean, a lot of them were still, even though it was Christianity, they were still doing the same exact, you know what I'm saying, practices and rituals that was done in ancient Kemet.
Right. Then it started to merge.
You know what I'm saying, the smoke, the incense, the way the structure of the kingdom structure is with the obelisks, you know what I'm saying, because with the bureaucracy, you know, from Norma started this new bureaucracy, you know what I'm saying, of a structure that was coming out of Tai City, and he just branched off and started his own type of bureaucracy. And this bureaucracy, you know what I'm saying, it started spread all over, you know what I'm saying, all over different empires. And they took this bureaucracy design and transforming it and throughout all different, you know what I'm saying, all different cultures, ancient cultures. You know what I'm saying? That's where the obelisks come from. You know what I'm saying? That's where they get the idea with the obelisks from the time of dealing with Queen Hatshepsut, you know what I'm saying? Because the obelisks, that's when you first see the obelisks, is from the 18th dynasty. All
right, so.
You got to watch some of those paintings. They got dark-skinned paintings, too. If you go to Google and type up Ethiopian
Russian.
Coptic Christian paintings, they got dark-skinned ones, too. Just type it up.
Yeah, because sometimes they'll just throw up a picture, a painting, it probably won't even be from the same time. And you had a lot of times, you had different missionaries coming in there trying to sell their little religion, representing, you know what I'm saying, trying to sell other people, you know what I'm saying, because their empire is so big, you can have missionaries there, you won't even know it, you know what I'm saying, until the news get to you. You know what
not saying? To mention, that the picture that you showed. The Ethiopians told a story of what was going on. You had those type of Syrian people living there, converting people. So they drew pictures of them. But you got the pictures of black saints as well. You go to Google and type up photos of Ethiopian black saints or Coptic saints, you can see them.
Russian icons.
But you think they black? They don't look like black people to me, though. They like some brown
people.
They look like the Habesha type,
like most northern Ethiopians who are admixture. Because they have a lot of Aryan descent.
Yeah, just like that picture. I showed you. I had sent it to your phone before. That's one of the oldest depictions. You know what I'm saying? And they didn't even really. A lot of them, they didn't even really color in the skin. They just drew it as symbolic. And it's like. You know, like some of them, you can kind of tell that they was representing themselves, but you can see the same same tribal tattooing on the neck of the Madonna.
But those lighter skinned Ethiopians that you see, that's a reality. And that northern part of Ethiopia, a lot of them were mixed for a long time.
Yeah.
For at least 3,000 years.
Yeah. It's like they mixed. They mixed with people that already look similar to them anyway, because you had darker people there with narrow features, with curly hair or straight hair anyway, from living in that highland region. You know what I'm saying? A lot of those people that came back, you know what I'm saying, looking different, or like some of they some some of them, some people that branched off from a common ancestor, you know what I'm saying?
Okay. All right. Well, there you have it, man.
But that depiction that you showed, though, Unc, that you put on the thing, is clearly a Syrian man. Syrians were there. So the Greeks, even the Greeks or the Syrian Greeks, tried to make Ethiopia a second Jerusalem because of the abundance of resources that they had.
Yeah, they had Syrian servants. They used to send during the time of Dawat the Second, one of his servants, one of his messengers was a Aramaic Syriac man. He was sending in the Portuguese to do business with the Portuguese.
I tell you what I really enjoy about reading Chancellor Williams' work, right? It's a point that he reiterates over and over and over again. On the finance, I know I can trace my bloodline back to the Maya. All right, if you know anything about the Maya, they in between Songhai and Ghana Empire, right?
And
they just refused to accept Christianity, Islam, or Judaism. They was like, the hell with that. That was one of their, you know, calls to fame. You know what I'm saying? And they had five core families, clans, that made up the Maasai. You know I'm saying? So that's why, you know, the Amun-Ra Squad is kind of structured like that. Let me kind of read this little piece right here, man. I think it's just an excellent discourse, man, to have these in-betweens like this. It's kind of like, it's kind of real helpful, man. It just adds to the flow of information. Just is what it is. And then, you know, sometimes we'll be going back and forth because we ain't got nobody to go back and forth with. Shit, who the hell we going to go back and forth? We were talking about the other day, like, damn, everybody else shit is just straight pseudo. And so, shit, that's all we can do is look at each other now. Fuck it. Put the gloves on.
That's right.
What else you going to do? Shit. I mean, hell. You know what I mean? I mean, Mr. Lee is in the building, but he's going to come up with some shit. You already know. I'll make up something and it'll be crazy. Watch. Just give him a couple minutes, I promise you. I promise y'all, 100%. Guarantee you, he's going to come up with something. Ain't going to be able to support it. He's going to be trying to be all emotional. Watch, yo. Yeah, it makes about 5 minutes. That's fair, man.
Let me slot this one in here, too, while we're at it, real quick. In Ethiopia, as well as in regions of Kenya, we have the Oromo people.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, the Oromo, they call their deity Waaka.
Yes, brother. Waaka.
Right.
Yes, brother.
Like, for example, like you have a title, you have Waaka Uma, which means like the creator of everything in the world. Okay. They also say Waaka is Hunda Bika, you know, omniscient, okay? You also have the Waaka as Hunda Tola, like omnibenevolent or all good, you know what I'm saying?
Waaka predates Amun-Ra and Asar. It's like the template. The Waakas of the Oromo, it's like a continuation of an older tradition of the hunter gatherers. You got the Kanso, you know what I'm saying, the different Keshetic hunter gatherers that's in Tanzania and Kenya, or even older than the people that actually practice pastoralism and agriculture, and this is a continuation tradition, you know what I'm saying, and this type of system spread throughout Green Sahara, you know what I mean, all throughout the Nile. You know what I'm saying? This Amun-Ra type religion. It even have Abrahamic type proto Abrahamic type customs in it. You know what I'm saying? That other people took and made it their own way.
Well, there's two points that I would make in response to that. One, I wouldn't necessarily, when you say pre Amun-Ra, you know, like, I would just be cautious on that part, only because, see, Amun and Ra is all over Africa. You know, it's not specific to Kemet. You know what I'm saying? These terms, you know, like predate know, dynastic Egypt. And even what we're calling Egyptian language is really a group of languages, a language family, okay?
Yeah,
so we're not just talking about a great mono language, because you talk about various languages.
Yeah, I know.
It's all over. Okay.
I would say the reason why I say the Amirah, because those people that migrated to Kemet came from the southwest Ethiopia, and that's where you find the Waka, you know what I'm saying, Waka and other, you know what I'm saying, systems similar to it, you know what I'm saying, similarities to the same type of culture, you know what I mean. And I know the predominant people of the Northern Nile, who are the Beja, you know what I mean, that their ancestors, they have a common ancestor with the Oromo, the Saho, the Aga, the, you know what I'm saying, various different people in the highlands and southern Ethiopia.
Okay, right. So, you know, but again, like I was saying, you know, it's not necessarily one comes really before the other. It's more so they all have common linguistic roots, you know, saying what I'm trying to get to, you know. So because we have, you know, dynastic Kemet starting, according to Robin Walker's calculations, 5,660 BCE, okay, adding to what we're calling glottal chronology, which puts the Cushitic language family predating what you're calling Egyptian, according to some researchers. Okay, again, that just depends on the methodology that you're using. But if we start to go into the methodologies as, let's say, posed by, you know, the Ifalabenga and what's called Black Africa or Negro Egyptian, as they say in French, okay, then the method changes. Now we're using more of an African-based method rather than method based off of the establishment and Indo-European. If you go off the establishment, the methods strictly off the establishment, the establishments of Indo-European, adding to biblical terms, okay? Because even Cushitic is, they're using it based off of a biblical term. Even though the word Cush or Kash or Ikushi, okay? Ikushi is predates, you know, the biblical narrative. But again, the early linguists in the 1800s, they took their cue out of Genesis chapter 10, so that's how you get Semitic, Cushitic, et cetera. But again, the whole concept of the one deity was already present in Africa before Christianity, Judaism, Islam. Now, second point, when you say proto-Abrahamic, basically, proto, you're saying this is the beginning stages of Abrahamic tradition. So now there's an implication that, all right, Abrahamic tradition, as we know it, starts in Ethiopia as opposed to in Western Asia. And that's a whole other discussion.
That pastoralist lifestyle and the agricultural, you know, so that, you know what I'm saying, that the lifestyle of the domesticator, you know what I'm saying, that started out of Ethiopia in the Green Sahara.
Right. But see, this is where I would be cautious of calling it proto-Abrahamic. And now we're saying, oh, well, because that means that someone else can come in and say, oh, see, Abraham might come out of that. Now, I'm not saying that you're saying that. This opens the door for spectators to come in and spin their arguments off of statements that we're saying. So that's why we have to be more cautious. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because Abraham, only thing Abraham means is father of many.
Right, but again, we're talking about Semitic languages. This is where we're going to Semitic, which we find its earliest stages in Western Asia, okay, as opposed to the Green Sahara. Now, you may have related languages, but these languages such as Berber, Cushitic, Egyptian, all these predate Semitic.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And Semitic has features of these languages as well as Indo-European features. So, research is good, discussion is great. We just have to make sure we don't give fuel to pseudo-ness.
Yeah, misunderstand.
Don't give them that. You know, just be, you know, specific. I wouldn't even say proto-Abrahamic. Leave that for Western Asia.
Yeah.
Hey, all right, so Judge, says, yeah, you would agree that those Europe, because we know Semitic language goes back to about, what, 4,300 years ago, and they got some of these strata from Proto-Sinaitic and the Levant. You are correct, and the Levant. It is dominantly influenced by Indo-European, but they kind of borrow some stratum from African languages. Would you say that?
I mean, of course. In that region, look at the region. In Western Asia, or as you refer to it as the Levant, this can be coined as a zone of confluence, as posed by Shikander Jung. Confluence meaning the merging and convergence of various languages, various cultures, various peoples, various traditions. Okay, kind of like a melting pot area. Because again, you have to remember that the Western Asia is a center of like trade and meeting of people of the Southern Cradle and the Northern Cradle, as posited by Diop in his methods and conclusion. So from the northern regions, let's say between the from the area of Turkey, where you find Proto-Indo-Hittite, which is a major branch of Indo-European, okay? Then you have other Indo-European language families in the regions of the Caucasus between the Black Sea and the Caspian Sea and the adjacent regions. And those people are coming south, okay? But you already had, Natufian type or descendants of Natufian type Africans already in the area of Western Asia. And they're speaking languages like Niger Congo-based languages, as we find with the Sumerians, because Sumerian has been demonstrated by G.J.K. Campbell-Dunn to be based on Niger Congo.
But those people came out the Sahara though. They spent their time in Sahara like for at least 10,000 years or so. No, not for 10,000, but 2,000 years or so in the Sahara. Before they even a lot of them even migrated towards the Levant.
Yeah, and that's why we're saying that these people that are called Sumerians, they speak Niger Congo. Because, again, Niger Congo comes out of the central regions of Africa. So, again, when you have the out-of-Africa migration, okay, you have these people speaking Niger Congo languages, so which is why you have Sumerian, okay? So this is pretty much like a cross-confirmation. All right. So, again, you have these type of speakers. You had Egyptian-type speakers. When I say Egyptian, I'm not speaking about a mono language. I'm talking about a group of languages, okay, that go into Levant because of trade. Because you got to remember that even as far back as the first dynasty under the African king Menes, or Mene, some say Narmer, you had the presence of these early Egyptian speakers holding trade and political clout in Western Asia, as can be demonstrated by X with Narmer's name on it, okay, stemming from the first dynasty. So you had these speakers in there, okay, and of course you have Cushitic speakers, all right? So these groups would be the African stratum, the base stratum for what you're calling later Semitic. But again, you have the input of Indo-European as well, mixing in at an early stage. So once you get around, say, 3,500, 3,000 BCE, around there, maybe as far back as 4,000, maybe, now you can get what's characteristically called Semitic, okay?
That's right.
But again, that's according to glottal chronology, okay? So when we say around 3 to 4,000 BCE, this is due to construction. We do not have any artifacts that go back, and we'll make that distinction. The earliest physical artifacts, always called attestation, only goes back to somewhere around 2500 BCE, all right, where Akkadian is written and this is the earliest of Semitic languages, attested. And the Akkadians adopted Sumerian cuneiform. And again, remember, Sumerians are non-Chicago speakers living in the Mesopotamian region between and around the Tigris and Euphrates River. All right. So the Akkadians borrowed and adopted the Sumerian cuneiform for there. We like to distinguish Sumerian cuneiform with Akkadian cuneiform. Okay? Because the Sumerian cuneiform is the original of that particular script. Okay? And then Semitic speakers adopted it, and, you know, of course, they did their own modifications for their own language because they became ruling class because they took over due to political and militaristic conflict.
Yeah, this is like what they call Ethio-Semitic, you know what I'm saying, which is found in like Eritrea, you know what I'm saying, the Punite kingdom. That came from a separate direction intended. A separate direction from the Proto-Sinaitic.
What I was talking about wasn't the Ethio-Semitic. That's a little just a slightly different.
I know.
Yeah, you're making a good point. We just was on two different parts. However, when we go to Ethio-Semitic, you know, I'm leaning more towards that what we're calling Ethio-Semitic. Ethio-Semitic is a branch of what they're calling South Semitic, okay? Where's the Arabic is Central Semitic. That the Semitic speakers, of course, the matrix area of Semitic would be in the Levant area, that they went south into the Arabian Peninsula and, of course, spread and then went into Ethiopia. And then mixing with the people and the languages, of course, you got the Aksumite Empire, et cetera. These are
I'm talking about the old Arabian language that they call like the earlier Ethio-Semitic, what they call Old Arabian. That was found like 2000 BC, before the Proto-Semitic offshoots came back into that area. You had another one that was influenced by the Meroitic script that was used, and branched off and used by the Zabezi dynasty.
Okay, well, in that case, we're talking about scripts. We're not necessarily speaking about language.
Abject language.
Okay. I think the overall part for me would be that the what we'll call it Semitic entries. It does like a back migration. These people, but again, you know, you had Cushitic speakers who left out. But then what comes back in is another language family, which is being called Semitic, but which was born out of Western Asia, goes back in with like the Aksumite Empire and even people before that.
Yeah.
Which in that area in Ethiopia becomes Ethio-Semitic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, eventually.
Mm-hmm.
You know, later on, now as far as the scripts, now you mentioned Meroitic. Someone also mentioned Proto-Sinaitic. Well, we have to go back to Proto-Sinaitic. Now, Proto-Sinaitic is simply a script, okay? Now, that's characteristic of the script that was rediscovered by Sir William Flinders Petrie in the early 1900s, somewhere around 1903, 1904, okay, in the expedition. All right, the only reason they call it Proto-Sinaitic is because we found it in the southern regions of the Sinai Peninsula, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, in 1999, researchers found the same script types which predated what Sir Flinders William Petrie found probably about 100 or 200 years or so in the middle regions of Kemet, in a place called Wadi al-Hal in the middle regions. But again, you go to that script, that's the earliest Semitic writing that was templated off of Egyptian script. But you got to remember that earlier you had the Akkadians who had their Panera plan. But again, this, what we're calling product centered, what is templated off of hieratic writing, or, you know, our language in Egyptian, we would call it more so like seshnashat or seshat, which means document writing, okay, or letter writing.
So they spread their bureaucracy all, you know what I'm saying, their empire, you know what I'm saying, throughout different regions.
Right. So once these Semitic speakers in the Sinai Peninsula and the middle regions of Kemet, they go back into the homeland and start to standardize it. So as they start to standardize what's being called proto-Sinaitic, and again, just for clarity, proto-Sinaitic only goes back to about 1800 BCE, okay, if that, okay? So when they go back up into Western Asia in the Levant area and it's standardized, now it becomes what you're calling the Canaanite script, okay? Canaanite and or Phoenician. And then, of course, further developments occur. Now you get, you know, Aramaic. Then you get Imperial Aramaic. Then from there, then you get some branches off becoming Hebrew, other branches, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Ugaritic and all those other branches. Later on, well, in the midst of that, you also get Meroitic. But Meroitic was not taken from Proto-Sinaitic. Meroitic was taken directly from Hieratic and Demotic. And then one last point, we'll call it the Ge'ez script, or Ge'ez, that the I think it's the Aksumite Empire used. I think now some people say, well, that came directly out of the Hieratic. But when you really compare it, it looks more like it came from the Proto-Sinaitic stream, not directly from the Hieratic and Egyptian. And this adds credence to saying that, well, to the premise that this script and this language we're calling Ethio-Semitic, that it came back into Ethiopia as well as the script. So, you know, you may have had some minor influences directly from the Nile, but I think those influences of even the writing comes down through the Arabian Peninsula and back into Ethiopia across that strait between Ethiopia and Arabia or Yemen.
It was Syrians coming in through Yemen, crossing in through Ethiopia, because Amharic has a lot of similarity to Aramaic. It's a cousin. It's Tigris, or what they refer to as modern-day Habesha. But those Semitic languages, if you go into the Omo Valley, some of those indigenous people, well, those people, because they come from Abu Sudan and different places as well, they got different languages. Habesha has became the global language. I'm sure Tawadu will talk about it for most of Ethiopia today. But they first only, you know, came through and got those Semitic or Ethio-Semitic only in northern Ethiopia. You know, it recently it spread through Oromo Valley, so a lot of people in Oromo Valley accepted it as their national language as well now. But it did come back in.
They used to use the script Ge'ez for Oromo, but the Oromo now they use Roman script now.
Yeah.
Let me go to this caller real fast here. Got 30 minutes. Then we can go to the after show if y'all feel up to it. Listen to the Amon Ra Squad. Y'all know how it go. I'm a Raw Squad up. We got, Team Osiris building. You know what I'm saying? We doing our thing. 901, your line is open. I'm a Raw Squad up.
901.
You got to turn your radio down.
My bad, brother. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Want to say something, brother?
No, I'm just over here listening to y'all, man. I'm listening to y'all getting in. Y'all having a good show so far.
Yeah, it's great getting
out. I just wanted to say what's up and peace to everybody. And I'm going to cop me one of them shirts. Matter of fact, I'm going to cop a couple of them.
Okay, brother. All right. All right. All right. And, now, he's just going to the link.
put your size and stuff. And if you can't do it on the site, because we're trying to get the store right on the site, just go down to the donation part and then hit me up on Facebook and put your name and your size and stuff in there, y'all, and I'll be able to put that together, address and stuff.
Oh, okay.
All right.
I got you, man. Y'all making a big difference, man. I'm glad y'all brothers doing this and staying consistent with it.
Oh, yeah.
And,
I'll be listening. Okay, brother.
Appreciate you, brother.
All right, brother.
Let me know when y'all ready to go ahead and beat up a see-through Hebrew. Let me know.
It don't matter. It don't matter.
You know. Well, you had 90, Lee. What is your question? What is your
Hebrew
question?
Hebrew is a mythological anyway.
What's good, man?
Where are you, mythological? Are you here? Can we hear you? Are you here?
Hey, I'm here.
Quick, brother. What is your question, Mr. Mythological?
Well, last week we touched on a few things, man, and, you know, I just wanted to clear up a few misconceptions. The one being Dr. Mayotte, she was speaking about the, you know, the King James Bible and what have you, and I tried to tell her, well, have you went back to, you know, the origins of the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the original scrolls, what have you, and also we touched on the Library of Alexandria. And you had stated that there was no Library of Alexandria and that they had not found any evidence of that. So I brought evidence today that they have discovered the Library of Alexandria. So we can kill that right now. It's dated to...
I ain't knocking them.
Okay, it's dated to 2004 is when they first discovered it. And this is Zahi Hawass. You can go to BBC News. They have a whole article on it.
Okay.
They said that it had 13 lecture halls. It's called the oldest university. It says, announcing their discovery at a conference being held at the University of California, Zahi Hawass, president of Egypt's Supreme Council of Antiquities, said that the 13 lecture halls uncovered could house as many as 5,000 students in total. He goes on to talk about it. 2,000 a year, but they have found it. A Polish-Egyptian team has excavated parts of the Berusian region of the Mediterranean city and discovered what looked like lecture halls of auditoria. 2,000 years ago, the library housed works by the greatest thinkers and writers of the ancient world. Then they give you the history, call it the birthplace of geometry, what have you. But you can check out that article. They have found it.
Can you put that link in the chat room for me, please?
I'm not on Blogtalk, huh?
And I appreciate the upgrade after I read it, if that's correct.
Just type in BBC News. Just type in BBC News online and Library of Alexandria Discovered. You can just type in just like that and it'll pop up.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with being corrected at all. But what in the hell does that got to do with your Bible?
Well, this is what we were saying.
How does that help?
You know, it's funny, Nazi. You know, I could have told you that Alexandria Library exists. The Greeks, I mean, the Arabs, the ones who found it. If it wasn't for the Arabs discovering those scriptures in Alexandria, there would be no Quran. They were Greek influence. So, yeah, you're right. I could have told you that.
Well, the whole thing is this. It's like when you present an argument, present all the evidence. You know what I'm saying? That's kind of a clue I was trying to give Dr. Mayotte. Like, present it in totality, not just, you know what I mean?
But the pure Semitic man, Nazi, is not black. He's not you still. So a pure Semitic speaker is not black. He's not you. Got some African in him, but he ain't you.
Yeah.
Okay, so basically, are you separating different black folks throughout the earth by culture or by ethnicity?
I'm separated by ethnicity and by genes, by DNA, by that 0.1%, that SNP.
Yeah, you're not even the same African as in Tanzania. You're not even the same African as in the highlands of Ethiopia.
No, you're not.
All that is understood, but I think that culture is really the biggest proponent that separates us, man. Because if you look at Egypt and you look at Africa, you had these different cultures there, who some would look back and say ethnically they were different because they had maybe different substratums of languages or what have you, but they were still on a continent of Africa. Ancient Egypt was not just indigenous to one group. You had various groups there.
You're partially true, but the difference is they had different cultures, but Egyptian culture is more similar to Nigerian culture than it is to a person in West Asia. I'm gonna be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
If you study the pantheon, or you study how the forces or the Neteru work, they work real similar to the Orisha. So I can agree that you have cultural differences, but you can honestly see a common thread, a common ancestor between the Nigerian and the Egyptian, the Tanzanian and the Kashmiri, or the person that develops further south towards Tanzania or Uganda, than the people in West Asia. When you get into West Asia, they have a lot of commonality with the Indo-European coming out of Central Asia or the Northern Hindu.
They have a common Green Saharan ancestor. That's what it is. They all come out from the Green Sahara.
Yeah, they got some Natufian ancestors that came out of Africa, but they also have a lot of Indo-European ancestors that come from Central Asia. You know what I'm saying? You make it in the Middle East, that's a melting pot. That zone is when you might find a woman with mighty conjugate DNA L4, or a man with mighty conjugate DNA L4, but his Y chromosome might be J or KT predominantly. It's more J's in Arabian Peninsula than it is E3B's. E3B is a Cushitic or East African Horner Y chromosome. You might find some smidges of E3A, but predominantly you have markers that develop over there in the Arabian Peninsula. Now, when you come to human gene, 99.9% of human genome is similar. 0.1% that makes up that single nucleotide polymorphosis, it differs because we develop in different geographical locations. So these people develop their own SNPs. You know what I'm saying?
Let me ask you this, because you're speaking of multi-ethnic groups in this area.
Can I ask you a question real quick?
We can pinpoint, man.
Go ahead. Can you just enjoy bringing forth the Library of Alexandria for us and prove it wrong on one point? Can we celebrate that one point that brother got on me?
Let me give you props,
although you give me a raggedy-ass BBC joint. That ain't Armor Ross Squad quality. Hold on. And what it says is, it says, let me read it verbatim. It says archaeologists have found what they believe, keyword believe, to be the site of the Alexandria Library, often described as the world's major seat of learning, what they believe. So you hit me back when they stop believing and know for sure. And pull the archaeological report so I can read that. That's what I'm looking for. I'm trying to help you out here, bro. But that one ain't going to cut it. But I'm saying, if you're right, yo, appreciate for the upgrade, though. But back again, how in the hell I got something to do with you and it being a see-through hate, bro? Please put that together.
The Temple of Alexander, probably a mosque right now.
They can say whatever it is. The title reads, Library of Alexandria. For right now, until they discover something else, I'm going to do what y'all do. That's what we're going with.
I would be more interested in the details of libraries and universities in the temples, you know, dealing in Kemet and others. What are those details? You know what I'm saying? The Library of Alexandria, okay, you know, Alexander of Macedonia, you know, came in and put that idea for that to be there, you know, in the Delta regions of Kemet.
Yeah, no doubt.
I'm more interested in, you know,
well, that's important. It's important, Sajetti, because it's dealing with a transition time when the Europeans took over the earth.
Well,
you know what I'm saying?
That's definitely, brother. That's well understood. Definitely. However, you know, again, you know, we are definitely African centered here. You know what I'm saying? And it's more important for us to know more about ourselves. Now, again, you're right. We have to know about what's going on with this transition. But we have to understand the details of what it transitioned from. You know what I'm saying? We focus on the transition. Okay, Library of Alexandria, again, we need to know that. However, what does the originals look like? What were we doing? I'm talking about in detail. You know what I'm saying? Because, again, when you go to a typical Kemetic temple, you have what's called the Chamber of Books. You know what I'm saying? We have papyrus rolls, et cetera. What's the word? In fact, how about this? Since we're talking about libraries, what's the word for library in African languages? Okay. What's the word for writing? What is the word for papyrus roll? You know what I'm saying? What's the word for a sentence? What's the word for word? You know what I'm saying? What's the word for a book? What are the names of these types of books? What are different categories of books? What are the names of some of the scholars? You know what I'm saying? What did they author? You know what I'm saying? I want to go into that because, I've discussed this with Ankh several times. And, again, it's not against Ankh at all. But we spend a lot of time speaking about, you know, the European part. Well, I want to have a discussion where we're strictly just talking about the actual African information, that specific history, apart from what Europeans took. Because, again, that means we're still putting them in the center of our attention and not ourselves. And after all this, we still don't even know what's the Kemetic word or African word for writing. We still don't know that as far as what's being discussed here. You know what I'm saying? Let's talk about what are the earlier religions of in Ethiopia. Now, we spoke about the Oromo. We spoke about the word Waka. That's why that was put in there. We need more of that. You know what I'm saying? Like, what's the structure of the temple? You know what I'm saying? Like, let's get into that.
Some of what you're saying is important, man, when you're talking about the lecture halls and everything like that. But, I mean, we're dealing with a conversation talking about the Bible, and so that's why we're in that time period. But what I was getting ready to do, if I was allowed to finish, was link it back, because you guys talked about the Mene Ptah Stela about a week ago, okay, and that not possibly being Israel. But I'm going to say that they would not have even been called Israel anyway at that time period, regardless. No. They, you know what I'm saying? You can trace them back before that. They have a Phoenician historian who actually, you have 3 to 4 European historians who have his work verbatim. And he actually speaks about the Jews and their culture, or the Judeans and their culture, close to 2000 BCE. So you can go back before the Mene Ptah Stela. His name is Sanuation of Berytus. S-A-N-C-H-U-I-A-T-H-O-N, Sanuation of Berytus, or Beirut. And he's quoted by one guy in particular, Porphyry Malchus of Tyre, who was against Christianity, which you guys were talking about earlier. He was against Christianity, and he argued against Christianity based on the older Judean culture and spoke about the culture, just about as in-depth as you can get as far as their cosmology and everything like that. And this is close to 2000 BCE.
So
it's a lot to go into.
2000 BCE.
Yeah, it's close to 2000 BCE. They date them till about till around like.
Hold on. So you telling me, Christianity didn't even exist in 2000 BCE. So how could this historian that exists then?
No. Listen, no. I spoke about the Phoenician historian, and then they have exact copies of his work. They're quoting copies of his work verbatim in their books. They're speaking about historian.
You know what, Nazi? They made that up. It's not real.
This one I'm gonna read right here. This is the African Origin of Civilization. This is the African Origin of Civilization by Sheikh Hadi Diab. This is what he said in here, and it's very important. It said in Egypt, the study of history rests largely on such written documents as the Palermo Stone, the Royal Tablets of Abydos, the Royal Papyrus of Turin, and Manetho's Chronicle. So those authentic documents is what Sheikh Anadiyah said. He called Manetho's work authentic. So this would be saying the same thing about Manetho's work, which many of our older scholars, black scholars, felt was authentic work. So to call this stuff, just because it doesn't agree
but a lot of Jews dissected that shit and changed it.
But you know a lot of
Dr. Antijoke, or Dia, they call him Dia, but Dr. Antijoke, speaking French, you know, a lot of his information, some of it is outdated, and some of it is not even factual. I mean, I'm not saying factual. When it came to his DNA testing of melanin content of Ursa Master Steppenrod, that was on point. But we got to understand his brother was a practicing Muslim, so he tried to correlate some belief systems with his science because he was a Muslim. So some things, just because he said it, I mean, it's 100% authentic. For example, there is really no proof that Manetho exists. And there is really no proof. Some people say Josephus exists, but you got a lot of people that can refute and say Josephus was a penmanship for a few Semitic writers that were there. So
you have other individuals, man, who were able to see this work firsthand. You can't have four or five different people across the broad spectrum of scholarship, man.
They broke it down, you know what I'm saying? They changed a lot of the you know what I'm saying, stuff. They were changing their own way.
We can say that about everything, man.
The white man is not the original Semitic, nor is the black man. I'm going to let you know that now. The white man is lying about the Middle East, just like some Afrocentric structure exaggerating.
When you say Semitic,
I just want to get that correct.
When you say Semitic, all you're telling me is people of African descent who migrated or were already in what we call Africa. We talked about this last week, man.
No, what I'm saying is original Semitic speaker of the Levant would have been a mulatto. They would have looked like Barack Obama. They would look like Alicia Keys. They would look like the people that live in Yemen today. And I think that those Arabs and those people of Palestine that's getting killed right now, those browner-skinned people, a lot of those people have the right to call themselves Semitic, and a lot of people are still know people's identity.
Have they?
People
okay,
have
so
do that
okay. The people that were there prior to the Sumerians, what was their DNA haplogroup?
Which one?
Before we even get to that, tell me the Sumerians. Give me the Sumerians' Y chromosome.
So some Sumerians.
So you saying? Wait a minute. So you saying the Sumerians were gay? You saying they Semitic then?
No. Listen. No. J predates Semitic language. The J marker goes back 30,000 years in the Arabian Peninsula or in that Levantian area. It goes back 30,000 years before Semitic even exists. So what I'm saying is that you had people in Mesopotamia that had J markers, but they didn't speak Semitic. The Sumerians was a mixed multitude of people. Some of them had E3B because they're some East Africans did go there, and they found E1 there. But it's small. It's minute. All you got to do is study the Marsh Arabs' DNA. If you study the Marsh Arabs' DNA, you can see L. The L marker comes from the Dravidians. Now, it makes sense that some of the Sumerians had some type of Dravidian common lineage because right under Iraq, you go into where?
We understand the different groups that was there, but let's get to the bottom line, what they tell you in the textbook, and what's that? That they can't pinpoint it on the Sumerians. Right.
No, they say the Sumerians proclaim that some of them came from Kish or West
They're guessing based upon the Lapis Lazuli because they figure, well, since they had they held this Lapis Lazuli in high regard and kind of like, yeah,
that's,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So they're saying that's probably where they come from, but that's a guess.
Some of them did come from that because when they did test the DNA, some of them had that Y chromosome L, which is the Dravidian marker, which makes sense. And then some of them had E3B, small smidges of them had E3A, which is E1B1A, but a lot of them had J markers. So what I'm saying is that it was already a Proto-Euphrates people that exist in that area, or the Ubanians who exist in that area before the Sumerians even were there. So what I'm seeing is, and don't get it twisted, they were darker-skinned people. Most people in those areas were darker skin. People look at the Chihuahua people. Their Y chromosome is the same Y chromosome as the people got in Japan. Y chromosome haplogroup D. They're not African, but they look African phenotypically, but genetically they're Asian. So the original J marker that exists 30,000 years ago was dark skin. But when he started branching off into subclass branches, like J1C3 or the Cohill marker, those people look different because the geographical locations that the original J markers went through, coming back down from the Georgia region, the Caucasus region. Because you got to remember, even Cro-Magnon man had Y chromosome IJ in Central Asia. If you look at the Wasser skull in Rome, which had mitochondrial DNA N, which is an offshoot of mitochondrial DNA L3, because L3 gave birth to N and M. But that N marker, dude looked like a straight
Yeah,
he
looked like
and two features.
He looked like Unk.
The Russell Stone looked, yeah, he looked similar to Unk, but his mitochondrial DNA was in. Look at this. So back 30,000 years ago, we know white people didn't even exist until around 6,000 to possibly 12,000 years ago based off SLC-2485 or SLC-4582. That's when pale-skinned people really come on the surface. Now, when it comes to lighter-skinned people did exist, but this is another strand. This is not albinism. Like the myth that Afrocentrics proclaim that they
tell
albinos. No. They're
tell
not.
Tell me this.
A few cells away from being it.
Tell me this, and this goes to what Sinjetti said earlier, too, when he spoke about when you guys were speaking about proto-Sinaitic and all that, right? And also the Sumerian cuneiform coming from, I can't remember exactly what area he said that the
Niger
Sumerian.
Niger Congo,
okay. Now, think about
some of,
this.
Some of,
how do the Sumerians come into the areas that they come into and the areas that they came and migrated to are not even Sumerian names. Like when you look at the river,
they have Asiatic
like
names.
They all have Asiatic names. The cities,
right.
What you know about the Sumerians was retranslated by the Akkadians.
That's true.
Go ahead,
Sinjetti. Go ahead, get in there.
I'm just throw this. I'm gonna let y'all continue, but let me just slide this in. Some of those words, early Semitic words, are what may be borrowed from Sumerian, and then into Akkadian. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
now,
right.
Example of this. In modern day, we can compare this between, let's say, English and Arabic. Okay. Now, English and Arabic are two totally different languages, okay? However, because of the conquest of Muslim Moors in Europe, okay, we can go to Spain, France, England, et cetera, all right? And during the so-called, well, the European Middle Ages, to be specific, all right, or the European Dark Ages, as they call it, because they're the only ones that went through it in the world, Arabic was the primary trade language between the 8th century, even all the way up to the 15th century, okay, was a prominent trade language. So a lot of those words entered into what you're calling English, of course, Spanish, et cetera. All right, so this just shows the borrowing of words from another language into another, okay? And you can have this, you know, vice versa, because you know, you have English words used in Arabic in general, okay? So that's just to show a corresponding language phenomenon.
Not to mention again, Sumerians were not there first. You had people living in those areas.
The Ubang culture was there first.
You had the Proto-Ubanian culture, you had the Proto-Euphrates culture, you had different people. I mean, to be honest with you, you have a predominant
shape marker. When you say Proto-Euphrates, you know they narrowed that down to find out who these people were, right?
Okay.
They said they're Semitic. And if you look at the work, you have the scholars that went into Mesopotamia, like Frankfurt, Oates, Myers, Spicer, Kramer.
That's my argument, God. They could have been
proto.
Hold on,
the Semitic substratum languages were already there prior to the Sumerians' arrival.
The Akkadians borrowed, and they were the Semitic speaking people. They borrowed a lot of their language from
I'm not saying Akkadian. I'm not talking about Akkadian though. Semitic, that's not the only Semitic group.
No, it's not.
That was just another Semitic group trying to reconquer what they already area that they already had.
Hold on, real quick. Akkadian is the oldest attested. There is no other physical evidence of Semitic speaking before Acadia. So anything else would be inference or some type of reconstruction that's abstract. There is no physical evidence that predates Akkadian as predates Akkadian in the sense of Semitic attested languages. There is none.
Okay, you have Professor Meyer's work.
Let me say this real quick. Before you even have, you know what I'm saying, Semitic language over there, you got what you call proto-writing, you know what I'm saying, with spread all over different areas of the world independently. It's like the Kemetic writing come from proto-writing and it evolved independently where it was at, you know what I'm saying, the Nile Valley, you know what I'm saying, and the writing is just Sumerian that was written by the Ensi or the priest were proto-writing even in 3500 B.C., you know what I'm saying, when the Kemetic languages were being formed, you know what I'm saying, the people in Sumeria were still proto-writing. You know what I'm saying? For example, the linear A and linear B that you find in Minoan and Mycenaean cultures were brought up independently from proto-writing, from civil writing. You know what I'm saying? With origins from the Shingo bone that you find in Tanzania, or the type of bone writing from hunter gatherers that you find in early China. You know what I'm saying? Like calligraphy. You know what I'm saying? It evolved independently.
We don't even have to go back that far though. We can just go prior to the arrival of the Sumerians to see the evidence that was there. The brother stated that there was no archaeological evidence there. That's not true. If you're familiar with Edward Meyer in Sumerians and Sea Mice in Babylon from 1906, this is L.W. King quoting him. He said that Professor Meyer had sought to show that sea mites were not only in Babylonia at the date of the earlier Sumerian sculptures that have been recovered, but also that they were in occupation of the country before the Sumerians. And they also, another scholar went on to show also from that was contemporary with Meyer, showed that the substratum of the Semitic languages was already there. And they're saying now that the
Listen to what you just said, the substratum of Semitic language. So,
yes.
This goes back to what Sanjetti talked about. So whoever the substratum of the Semitic languages were, they probably come from that area, and they mixed in with those proto-Cushitic-speaking people, or not Cushitic, but those people that came out of Africa and traced the dialect of Semitic that we know in the Levant. But you just said you get what I'm saying. So it probably was a stratum of Semitic language or Semitic language speakers that was over there before the Semitic language itself. Now I can
Let me read it first and then touch on it.
They're talking about people that's talking without even having a script, just talkers. They're not talking about the actual script.
Let me give an example of the substratum and how this can work and a corresponding example. Let's take Latin. Okay. Let's go to Spain. All right. So the Romans took over Spain. Now the Romans are what? Latin speakers. Okay. So how do we get what we're calling Spanish? Of course, when the Muslim Moors enter into Spain and take political and social economic power, then Arabic becomes the dominant language, okay? So Latin and Arabic, two independent but complete languages, are the substratums of what you're calling Spanish. Okay, so again, it's the primary core of Spanish is Latin, but then you have this strong element of Arabic, okay, into what we call Spanish, or specifically Castilian. Okay, Castilian is technically what we think of as Spanish. There's actually several different languages that are in Spain that's actually Spanish. Okay, so a substratum means the languages that were present in a specific region that may have converged over time and then gave birth to another language, which has the features of two or more languages that predated as predialectical parents. So that's what we mean by substratum. It doesn't mean these are elements of languages. These are complete languages that go into input of the daughter languages. So again, back to the Sumerian, okay, or the Proto-Semitic, or the terms that you're using, brother Nasir. The substratum languages are already there, meaning these are complete languages that are already present in their region. And then over time with convergence, all right, you get what you're calling proto-Semitic. After generations and generations of contact and borrowing and inheritance of earlier complete languages. You follow what I'm saying?
I'm with you. I'm listening to you.
So again, you know, we're not having a problem with proto-Semitic being in the region of Mesopotamia, okay? That's definitely understood and established. So you're correct in that point.
What do you call? You saying proto-Sumerian or proto-Semitic? What are you saying?
I said the presence of what we're calling proto-Semitic in the region of Mesopotamia. Yes, that is correct. So we're definitely in agreement. But I've also remembered that.
So are you saying that they weren't speaking Semitic? Because you would have to be saying that these symbols that they were carved on clay tablets or what have you prior to the arrival of the Sumerians, and the Sumerians kind of adopting it unto themselves. You're saying that they couldn't pronounce, like when I saw a symbol, I couldn't.
They had no phonetic value.
No. We're talking about spoken languages. We're not talking about the. I wasn't talking about the writing. I was talking about spoken language.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
The writing comes from the Igi people, the NC priests.
No, but we're talking before them. We're not on the Sumerians at this point. We're prior to them. We're prior to the
arrival.
You're giving me textbook answers.
But you're talking about proto-stratum, and it goes back to what Chinjetti was saying earlier, and what I was trying to say earlier. Those people that spoke that language of the stratums, they had a lot to do with creating the Semitic language, and the Levant possibly came from that Mesopotamian region. I mean, even if you go into Central Asia, the first Indo-European speakers come out of Central Asia, Proto-Indo-European speakers. They come out of that Turkish region. Now, you have to understand something. Turkey is right above Iraq. Hello, Turkey is right above Iraq. And these first Indo-European speakers were not pale-skinned type Caucasians. They were olive skin tone or light brown.
They linked the Etruscans as the ancient Anatolians, based on the DNA.
Yeah, it makes sense though. What's wrong with that?
No, I'm just touching on what you just said. That's all.
It makes sense, and they wasn't white. You also had people. See, the thing is with this white boy, not just this white boy, but this northern white boy. He has no history. The only history that the European that ruled the world they got is Vandal and Viking. That's it.
Don't go
back to the fight. He's not even a Greek. Even the Greeks and the Romans considered themselves to be darker than the pale-skinned people. I forgot the Roman name. I think it was a Roman or a Greek. He said, I am not dark-skinned or black like those Egyptians, or I am not pale like the tribes of the north. They consider themselves to be olive-skinned or just Turanian race shit.
The Arabs call themselves swarthy-skinned. They're not even the Sami people, which are the Alpine people that you find in southern Balkans and places in Ireland and places like that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
That's a whole different people too.
These people, this northern European is trying to steal people's history globally, especially North Africa with their fake ass Turanian race shit, and he's there trying to steal West Asian history and West Asian culture, and he's trying to steal Greek history. He's not even a Greek. The Greeks were not, they didn't even fuck with the people of Northern Europe. You know what I'm saying? They didn't even deal with them. And if you study the DNA of Greek men, they had their own unique E marker. People don't know that. That comes out of Abyssinia, go through North Africa, develop a E1B1B1C, go through Albania, go through Crete, then go through Albania, then end up over there. And they mixed in with the indigenous European women with mitochondrial DNA H. That's why when they put out that new article recently saying the Minoan DNA proves that they were European only maternally. They ain't talk about the paternal lineage. And that goes back to the Minoan. So what I'm saying is that you have to study these people. This white boy from Northern Europe is either a R1B, M269, or a goddamn haplogroup I with a mitochondrial DNA H or X. He has nothing to do with none of the people that he claims at all.
Yeah, that's a potential agent.
He's a damn vandal. He's a vandal.
Yeah.
He's not even a damn Aryan. I don't even know why Hitler used that shit. He's not an original Aryan. Come to find out, this bastard had half a group E. You can look up Hitler had half a group E on his paternal side, which goes to show that one of his great-great-great-great-great-grandfathers was some type of Berber. It came out of North Africa, or Amazigh speaker that came out of North Africa and went up there because he had an E1B1B marker. These people are freaks and liars, man.
So let me ask the squad this question: what's your take on the Habil rule, and also based on linguistics, can you pinpoint who a particular group is and where they came from?
Habil can be you know what I'm saying, ancient people that go back and forth, go cross over. You know what I mean? It was just used as a, you know what I'm saying, at a point in time, just used as a certain class of people. You know, so you could be any color or shade. You know what I'm saying? Poverty doesn't have a color or ethnicity.
Yeah. As far as Habil, now I do know some people will say Habil doesn't have anything to do with the word Hebrew.
Right.
I'm not in agreement with that. I actually do think the two words, you know, are certainly related. It's just pronunciation. However, you know, with you take the word Hebrew is an anglicization or Englishization of a Canaanite word, Ha-Eber. Okay? Because again,
right.
People say, well, Hebrew is a Hebrew word. Well, Hebrew is not a Hebrew word. Hebrew is Canaanite
word. You do know I said Habaru.
Yeah, now, I understand that.
Okay.
All right, I'm positing that is basically the same word. That's
okay.
What I'm
right.
Okay.
Just,
all right.
Just do a couple of steps. Now, it's Canaanite for Ha and Eber. Ha or H-A being a definite article meaning the. And then Eber or I-B-R meaning, like Bud said, to move about, the crossover. Simply a word for nomad. Others may translate it as vagabond, et cetera. All right. This is not an ethnic nor a racial designation. Okay. It's
that's right.
The lifestyle of a group of people. Okay.
Yeah, today
they say Bedouin. They don't use the same words. Today they say Bedouin.
Yeah, they'll say like a Bedouin. Okay. So again, it's describing a lifestyle of pastoralist type people being described by Semitic speakers, namely Canaanites. Okay, Canaanites are describing these people. Okay, because again, you know, this is not a people who have cities. They're not people that settle down and create and build villages. Okay,
mm-hmm.
They are more they're camp builders. Now again, there's nothing specifically wrong with this. This is just their lifestyle. Even
you
can
ask me to do the same thing.
Wait. I was going to say touch on that for a minute because I was going to say if you go to the interior of Africa, you see the same lifestyle.
Right. This is where I was going.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. There's nothing wrong because a lot of times we, in the past, gotten into bashing, you know, the term. But again, even in Africa, you have pastoralists living in Africa. You have, you know, city dwellers in Africa. You have hunter-gatherers in Africa, okay? You have agriculturalists in Africa. So there's nothing wrong with the actual lifestyle, okay? That's just how they live. But again, we just want to be clear on who Hebrews are. Like, for example, like today, by lifestyle, you know, I wouldn't be Hebrew because I don't live in a tent. And this is actually an argument that I had with a quote-unquote brother of the Hebrew faith, just to be specific, Hebrew faith, because he said, I'm a Hebrew. I'm like, well, do you live in a house? He says, yes, I live in a house. So he said, well, in our technicality that disqualifies you from being a Hebrew. Okay? Well, then I said, well, do you move from house to house? He says, no, I live where I live for a couple of years. Well, you're not a Hebrew by definition. You don't move from house to house.
But what's more important, Sinjetti, is could you retain a cultural identity? Based upon that culture, can it be pinpointed to a certain area?
Can I say
what you're saying, what it seems like the squad is saying is that because these people are nomadic type and going from area to area and don't have any particular cities of their own or what have you, that they don't have culture, that they don't
They have a culture. All people have a culture. Let's understand what a culture is.
Because you have to have a core group.
Yeah, listen. Understand, let's define culture. See, culture is our prescribed ways in which you solve your problems, such as food production, how you obtain your food, okay, living arrangements, family structure, et cetera, and how you preserve these things, and how you just control prescribed behavior. That's what culture is. So, yes, they have culture. Okay? Now, over time, now people who move from place to place, if they're in contact with other groups of people, more than likely they're going to adopt different customs from other people that they feel is useful.
Can we pinpoint their original starting point? Are we able to do that based upon the three different groups that spoke about these people?
A Fulani that goes all through the Sahel belt of West Sudan all the way through Mauritania has the same similarity for his lifestyle as a Bedouin coming out of Arabia. A nomad or someone that's just passing by or crossing over, or Passover, as the Jews say, it's all the same. It's a lifestyle.
Yeah.
It's just a lifestyle. But they have a slight difference based off the geographical location that they come from. People have been nomadic since the beginning, going from one place to the other. I mean, hell, if it wasn't for the out-of-Africa migration, there would be no people outside of the continent. You know what I'm saying? It's what people migrate.
See, when you say that, when you say out of Africa, that can be confusing because are you defining it by modern borders or what's the extent of the so-called Africa? What's the extent of it?
Modern borders, because I'm gonna tell you something. I'm gonna let
you serious?
Say something. Hold on, listen. Let me say something, brother. The Middle Eastern tectonic plate is not on the African tectonic plate. Let's be for real. The shit broke off. It's not on the same tectonic plate. You can look it up. All y'all can look it up. If you study geology, you can learn about tectonic plates. They're not even on the same tectonic plate. So, it's just the truth. So what I'm trying to say is that the way we understand Africa today, if it wasn't for those people leaving out of southeast Ethiopia or southern Ethiopia, crossing through Yemen, crossing the Red Sea to go through Yemen, and then Oman, and from Oman through Pakistan, going south towards India, some going towards Iraq, some going towards Iran. I mean, Iran, then going towards Iraq, and then from Iraq they go to Turkey, and from Turkey they go to the Caucasus region. Because the Caucasus region is minor and major. You see what I'm saying? Other people keep going south towards India. If it wasn't the people leaving out of Ethiopia that we know today, modern day Ethiopia, southern Ethiopia,
would the Natufians be out of Africa?
Yes,
of course.
That's another out of Africa migration. They left out of East Africa around 15,000 years ago. That's another out of Africa migration after the second out of Africa migration.
Wait a minute. Nasir. Because see, you're jumping around with all these different questions all over the place. Stay focused, family. Okay. Your first question was, can we pinpoint a culture? Or et cetera, or a starting point of the Hebrews. Like, just focus on that, just answer that, then jump to the rest. Let me ask you this. Now, have you, in your research, have you pinpointed? Because, see, for us, we're not, you don't have, like, vested interest in specific part of what is their original culture. Like, we're straight, African. In the modern so-called borders.
What does that mean? Define that.
What do you mean about
when you say we're straight African, right? Who are you talking about, and when, and where? Where are these straight African people at in the world at 4000 BCE? Are you saying that East Africa was are the same people that you're talking about, or what?
Okay. When I say we, I'm talking about, Brother Ngozi, Brother Anke Kat, Young Brother Lion, myself, Ishmael Arbet. All right, that's what I'm talking about. People on our squad, that's what I'm talking about. we're concerned more so about the cultures within the so-called modern borders that you're that we're calling Africa is what we're concerned about. Now, you're more concerned, based on your question, the culture of the original Hebrews. So, you know, we don't have vested interest in that, but you do. So I'm asking you, have you done the research to find out the original culture, customs, et cetera, of the original Hebrews?
I haven't openly asked that question because I asked about the Habaru. And I guess you're assuming that, you know, because I'm Israelite, I'm asking about the Hebrew culture. Okay, because
Habaru, Hebrew,
they're connected.
But again,
linguistically, go ahead, go ahead.
No, what I'm saying is, earlier I said that I equated Hebrew with Habaru. So if you prefer, and that's not a problem, if you prefer that I pronounce it Habaru, so that we could be on the same page, no problem. So let me rephrase the question. So you're more concerned about the Habaru, their original culture, customs, et cetera, their history, their traveling paths, whatnot. Have you done this research?
They would be one group I would be concerned about, and yes, based on their some of the aspects of their culture, dealing with the cosmology, because they retain a creation story of Heliopolis also the Memphite theology and many things that the Judeans were dealing with. Yes. Their ancestors would have been those in East Africa, as well as stretching to Mesopotamia.
Okay, all right,
yeah.
Problem. Here's the issue. Yeah. Because let's get focused here. Now, the Habaru, as written about in the letters, and what I guess they're calling it Amarna letters, right, of a Canaanite Semitic ruler or chieftain, he's writing to what, Akhenaten, also to Amenhotep III, complaining about Habarus who are attacking towns and doing raids and stuff. Okay? They're not in these Amarna letters in the 18th dynasty. These kings or chieftains in Western Asia or Canaan land, as you might call it, are not talking about East Africans. They're talking about people in Western Asia, in Canaan land. They're not talking about East Africans. Okay. Now there's no Egyptians that call themselves Habarus. There's nothing in that. So now
I understand that. But based on the social class, we can tell who they are.
No, there's no native Egyptians who call themselves that. There's no record of that. Now, next point. Can you describe? Now, you said a cosmology of Habarus.
First of all, wait a minute. You went to the Armana letter. You're dictating the argument because you went to the Armana letter saying it based on Canaanite rulers. Actually, they're spoken about prior to that by the Egyptians and also spoken about by the Sumerians prior to that.
Yeah, those people.
What
those
is
people
it? But
they don't know Lexus.
Okay. Look.
And go ahead.
Okay. All right, look, you know, give us some descriptions of the customs. Like, give me an example of a custom. One custom of a Habaru, for example, are they patriarchal or are they matriarchal? Let's get specifics. You have this information. Give me a custom of the Habaru.
The information that I probably would give you on them would be based on three sources. It would be Mesopotamian sources showing that these people were basically living in the hill country and that they would form alliances with certain political groups in Mesopotamia. And also in the Canaanite culture, you see them forming certain alliances and also that they have their own, because you said that they did not have cities or did not have what I'm saying is that we see them actually taking over cities or territory and it becoming their own and it becoming their own area. No, they're not Harians because we see them in southern Levant, close to the border of Egypt. Okay.
Hold on, y'all.
We would expect somewhere along the line for their stories to be documented or written down. It was written down at a later date. Then, you know, maybe the date is not good enough for you. Okay, but their story is documented in the Bible. We have these same people saying the same stories that the Habaru said. I don't hear Europeans claiming to be Habaru. I don't hear Europeans claiming to be Habaru.
Oh, okay, I got you. All right,
Go ahead.
All right. Habaru wasn't black, though.
Well, what I'm not hearing are... To my question, I'm asking you. I didn't ask about the geographic location, which again, you gave good information.
I don't know what qualifies it for you. If the Bible qualifies it for you, because it qualifies it in a sense for me.
Nasir. Listen. I'm not trying to make an argument with you. All I'm saying is I was asking a question. Now you gave information, which is good information, but it did not address my question. Okay, had I asked you, do they take over cities? You answered that question, but I didn't ask that. Okay, do they? You said something about something that they lived in the hills. If I asked you, what type of environment do they live in? You would have answered that question, but I didn't ask that. I asked, can you give an example of a custom? Now let me define a custom. A custom is a prescribed practice between people in a culture. For example, in the Ifa tradition, okay, we have a custom when we greet an elder, especially a Babalawo, that we bend, go down on one knee and we take one hand and touch the ground as a form of respect. That is a custom, okay?
They have no literature at the dates that we're talking about that are known to be found anywhere on planet Earth. If you're talking about the ones that the Sumerians spoke about at around like 2500 BCE, they have no literature. We just have the stories from the Sumerian point of view. We have the stories from the Canaanite point of view, and we have the stories from the Kemetic point of view. They never told their story, at least at those dates. What I am suggesting is that the biblical stories, at least of the Old Testament, are their stories.
Okay.
No. It's just a Pacific tribe story. I mean, you had many different nomadic groups over there. You know what I mean? The stories of the Bible that you're talking about were translated from the people of Judah, where those people are Aramaic people that speak an Aramaic dialect called Yiddish. The only reason they call them Hebrew in the Bible because that's a Greek.
So you're saying that the people of Judah speak what language?
Yiddish. It's not Hebrew. Yiddish.
Are you? Oh, okay. So you're saying at let's say 1200, let's say 1000 BCE. Are you saying these people speak what now?
You said 1000 BCE?
Yeah, you talking about modern times?
No, I'm talking about the people that immersed in Judah.
The people
of the highlands and the people of Judah are two different people. The people that you call Israel or the kingdoms of Samaria is different. They live the same similar lifestyles, but they're different tribe clusters.
Okay, I haven't saw that information. I'm basing mine off Ramses II when he captured some of the cities of Judah, and he said that these cities belong to Judah, Melech, or the kings of Judah, and also based on the Phoenician.
Oh, Yahoo. That's not Judah.
I'm not talking about Jehu. I'm talking about Ramses II. I'm talking about, hold on, let me pull it up real quick.
It wasn't no Judah then.
Yes, it was. I'm going to pull it up. It's in Ramses II. Pull it up real quick. On one of his, Okay, I got it right here. It's archaeologists discovered some sculptures upon the walls of Thebes in ancient Egypt at the magnificent temple of Karnak. Among them was a figure of an enemy captive with his arms tied behind his back with a shield covering him. Upon the shield was written in Egyptian hieroglyphs, Judah Malik land, which means the kingdom of Judah. And this was after the descriptions of other ones before him. Normally, like how they write it, how Jonathan said that they'll describe certain tribes prior to that and then sum it up by saying that these are tribes of Judah. So that's one instance from Ramses II, or actually Shishak. And then another instance would be at around 2000 BCE, the Phoenician historian making reference to Judah.
Let me make a side point, if you don't mind. I think ultimately the issue that we may have with the Israel/Judean paradigm is not so much whether they existed or not, because I understand that a lot of our Hebrew Israelite brothers of the Hebrew Israelite faith, you know, go to great lengths to try to prove the existence, you know, of Israelites or Judeans, et cetera. Now, there are plenty of records that demonstrate the existence of these people, and we're very aware of that. So we don't deny the existence of Judeans or even Israeli-type people, okay? Now, some brothers may get the chronology, you know, backwards and incorrect because they want to push it into an antiquity where they don't belong, okay? However, we do recognize them in certain periods of time. Where our issue is more so that the brothers and sisters of the Hebrew, Israel-like, Judean faith try to monopolize the concepts of history. They try to monopolize the concept of God as if we got it from them, these Israel Judeans, or they have the true religion. That's ultimately where we have the issue.
But that's not true.
Evidence. No, hold on. So this may not be what you're saying. I'm saying this is across the board. Like,
yeah,
as if Abraham brought the concept of God to everyone else when we already had it. This is ultimately where we're having an issue because I'm going to call it Semitocentrist. Semitocentrist push this idea as if we owe them something, okay? Like, okay, well, we need to learn from you. We need to learn about prophets from you. We need to learn our holy scriptures from you. We don't need you because we had it before you and in more abundance before you even existed. For example, like, we don't need Abraham. For what? Okay? It's a non-necessity for learning and enlightenment. Okay? It's also that's why I bring up, like we'll talk about the Library of Alexandria, you know, and, the Septuagint. Okay, we have plenty of information on that. What we're not talking about in abundance is the actual African information, that history. Okay? We're talking about transitions. Okay, well, you have to understand, where did it transition from? You don't even understand where it transitioned from. You're just looking at the transition and the after effect. Where did it come from?
I think the first mistake you're making and that the squad is making is by saying that Africa is only the modern borders of today. I think that's a mistake. And the second thing is when you look at the connection and the parallels between the Mesopotamian cultures prior to the Sumerians and also the Sumerians, but it was there. You see it before they even arrived there or got there and took it over. You see parallels and connections. You see what they call the Euro expansion. And all of a sudden at 3000 BCE and after, you see an explosion of information coming into Kemet like never before.
I disagree.
You know,
the reason why I disagree is because you find the god Anubis in the Sahara, or you find a lot of art in the Sahara of Kemet, and in the Sahara 6,000, 7,000 years ago. Let me tell you something about this thing that this is
Hold on. Go ahead.
Hey, no, let me just say this, though, bro. Africa you know, that term. You got, I mean, because I'm just going to be honest with you. The continent was a lot more, when you talk about borders, you say you got to watch how those borders are, you know, how you use the borders. We see modern day Africa. But if you want to go back 3,000 years, it was a lot more borders than what it is now. Because the people
in Egypt,
let me
let 916, your line is open. Go ahead, Gordon. I'm sorry. I'm on the line. Go ahead.
I was gonna say,
man. Hello?
The people, yeah.
Man, you was going in on it, huh? Go ahead, man. I'm listening.
I was gonna say 3,000, 6,000 years ago, the people in Egypt did not identify with the whole continent. Africa was a lot more divided then than it is now. For example, the people in the Mediterranean part of the continent, the people in Nigeria did not identify themselves as Africans 6,000 years ago, if you look back to Nigeria, or even 3,000 years ago. This shit was all about trade and market. So the people of now was really focused on the now. Even though they had commonality, because a lot of this shit comes out of the Sahara, black African that comes out of the Sahara, the commonality, people go different directions and do their own thing and control their own borders and their own route. So I'm sure a person of the now knew, hey, you know, I ain't from that forest. I'm not from down there, but I do trade with them. Or a nigga, a brother in Sudan that said, well, you know, people in the land of Yam, which is modern-day Cameroon, according to one of my books, they did trade with these people, but they didn't identify themselves with each other. But today, Africa tectonic plate is what we know. And all those countries, 53 countries on that tectonic plate of what we know today as modern-day Africa is what it is. But you best believe back then the people that are now did not identify with people in West Asia or they didn't identify with people in the heart of Africa. They were just focused on the now. And a lot of people in Asia was divided. If you study your biblical myths, they was always fighting among other types of Asiatics. Syrians didn't fuck with Persians. Persians didn't fuck with Syrians. The Arabs didn't fuck with the. It was always divided up over there in West Asia. It was all about market and trade.
You have rivalries even on the continent. You have rivalries even on the continent of Africa. You know what I mean? Just like the people of the northern now are predominantly of the Tamil culture is Bedouin. A better
one. Yeah, I mean, that's understood, man. But what I'm saying is not so much that the borders were defined at 3000 BCE. The borders were I'm talking about the original. And you probably know this, Aunt Goldie, that scientists believe that we come from a pool of about 10,000 people. Modern man comes from a pool of about 10,000 people. It's how we got all these different variations and what have you. So I'm saying the original homeland of these people stretched from modern-day Africa and its borders over into the Levant. That's what I'm basically saying.
But hold on, brother. But your people never left. That's what's funny.
The only difference is culture.
Let me just say this, though, God. Your people did not leave and go to the Levant. From that small migration that left out, it was a small population of people that left out. It was a bottleneck on humanity at certain times because of the zones that was, the changes that was going on, which was a reduction of a population. But what I'm trying to say is your people, particularly, did not leave out. We went west. Our ancestors, I'm just being honest with you, our ancestors have been in West Africa for almost 20,000 years. When the Sahara was vegetation, and after that shit dried up, a lot of our ancestors went south. Others went back east. And when they went back east,
they went north.
And when some went north and some went east, and when they go east, they meet up with other groups who are already hovering around the now with E3B. Because even if you look at the people in the Nile Valley today, the predominant haplogroup there is E1B1B. It's a Horner haplogroup. You find a new group of E1B1A, which shows that some of the Egyptians did come out of Sahara. But when they get there, they meet up with people that's already gone off the Nile, yo.
Wait a minute. So you saying E1B1B is where? E1B1B comes from where?
Man, I live in the Nile Valley.
It comes out of Ethiopia. It comes in the Nile Valley. It comes from Ethiopia.
Okay, because you have that marker found amongst the Sumerians.
Yeah, that's what I just said earlier. The E1B1B comes out of Abyssinia. It's younger than E1B1B is only 24,000 years old. E1B1A goes back 30,000 years. But we both split from EPN2. EPN2 goes about 35 to 38,000 years. We split. So one group goes one direction in the Sahara, another group follows later on in the Sahara. You get what I'm saying? So you find, you see, you ain't living amongst one another. But we, but we're different subclimb branches of E. Now the oldest.
I don't know. I think they took me off.
50,000 years.
No, you still on.
The oldest E goes back 50,000 years, but our branch of E goes back 30,000, and E3B comes around, you know, 24,000. It follows behind us. It's like a little brother clad to us.
Okay,
but you
so
see
so.
That predominant now.
I don't want to go too far. So basically, what you're saying, Sinjetti, is that it was I know Ngozi was just talking, but you can answer this too. So Sinjetti specifically though. So what you're saying is that Egypt prior to the dynastic period and going into the dynastic period was only comprised of what you would call ethnically Africans, one indigenous group.
Majority of the people in Egypt were from the Sahara and from the Nile called Ethiopia. E3B and E3A. In the north of the Mediterranean part,
type of desert, and you can see exactly what those people look like. They wore the foes, they wore the afros on their head, which is called the tepa, which symbolizes the sun disk, and they symbolize it. You see that in the Middle Nature when you see the sun disk. They do. They lived the culture out.
They were predominantly African. Mitochondria DNA is over there with L3, because you got to remember, the blueprint of the governance structure of Kemet comes from Tashay out of Sudan. You can study that 7,000 years ago. You got the Nubian A group, Nubian B group, Nubian C group, all the way down to X. So the structure of it comes out of Sudan. That's another thing. A lot of people get up in Egypt confused with Sudan or Nubia, and it's not the same. It's like crossing the border between Texas and Mexico. You know what I'm saying? It's a draw. It has a draw. It's not the same.
You're telling me two different things, though, man.
Okay, let me answer the question. I want to respond to the brother. No, I never insinuated that Egypt was a monophenotypically populated place. Okay, you had people from Western Asia who would have primarily dwelled or inhabited the northern regions, more so around
right.
in the Delta regions. Okay.
Right.
They were never a majority, okay, at any point. Not until the Arabs come in do you get majority of Western Asians
That's right.
in northern Kemet, especially around the Delta region, okay? So
That's
any
right.
Western, we have to also remember that we're dealing with an entire country. So, you know, you might have like 1,000 people. That's like nothing, you know what I'm saying, compared to a country full of several million people of different
right.
types of Africans. So, again, yeah, you're going to have Western Asians in there because there's no borders, there's no natural borders blocking them from going from Western Asia into Kemet. There's no natural borders, so you could just walk over there. So we're not insinuating that they were not present. That's not the implication here. What we will say as far as the population, you're dealing with predominantly African people, and they have different types.
That's
of
right.
You have woolly hair. You have curly hair. You have thin nose, straight aquiline nose, etc. All right. So you have different
yeah.
ethnic groups.
That's the difference.
Yeah, from inside
okay.
the continent, from west of Kemet as well as south of Kemet. Okay.
That's right.
Okay, that's interesting, man. That's interesting based on the evidence on the ground, because
but
as
Nazi,
we know, go ahead.
Nazi, please know that those West Asians that came in living in the Delta were not you, or they were not the white boy that's claiming them. These people had their own phenotype. They looked something like a Northern Indian. Those West Asians that came in, they were not white nor they were not black, but they were people of color. They brought certain
yeah,
things.
They
continent.
The crazy thing is that I don't see the Egyptians or I should say Narmer's group. I don't see him or some of the earlier dynastic kings making a distinction between who was who ethnically. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, listen, brother, people in the Nile were crossbreeding with Eurasians since they first got there, since the first back migration the most known one 7,000 years ago. You have more women who were coming in early Paleolithic time with foreign mitochondria DNA, like M1 coming back in Africa. Men was crossbreeding with them. In the Atlas Mountains of Morocco, those black men were crossbreeding with women with the Sami mitochondria DNA down there 10,000 years ago. So you have more foreign women mitochondria DNA. Like, for example, the indigenous North African mitochondria DNA has been ringing around for a long time. It's M1 and U3 or U6. U6 don't come from Africa. Nor does M1. M1 is one of the first daughters of mitochondria DNA L3. They gave birth to M and then branched off into M1 and came back to back migration. So what I'm saying is that you had mixed people even a little bit prior before Nama living up there. It wasn't about race in the sense the way we see it today. But again, Egypt was predominantly black Africans. They come from the south, Haitians and the Bedarians. They were predominantly black Africans.
The diversity, though.
Say what? So,
those,
I mean, because this is on shows I've listened to in the past, this is what I was told. This is what I heard. I heard Ankh and some of the other brothers discuss Narmer and the followers of Horus, or the Horus clan, or the Bird clan, or the Smiths, coming into Egypt and taking it over, right? Now, we weren't told, though, that the people in the Delta were already dealing with Horus prior to Narmer arriving. Prior to Narmer's arrival. But we weren't told that part of the history. And also...
Go ahead. No, I was going to say, I have an argument of my own. I don't believe that Narmer unified Upper and Lower Egypt. Narmer unified the borders between West Asia and North Africa, or Kemet. Because there was a lot of trade going on. You find coins that this dude, all the way in the Sana'a. This dude, it wasn't a racial thing like people think. This dude, if you get the book called When Egypt Ruled the East, those people that Saharianized those people in West Asia, they were controlling those borders for a long time, Africans from the Nile. So it wasn't that he was unifying Upper and Lower Egypt. He was getting them niggas together to keep them in order, to keep the ties in West Asia. That's why the Egyptians always were struggling. Let me just say this, though. That's why the Egyptians were always struggling with certain borders in West Asia, because you always had a few West Asians who tried to retaliate or become revolutionists against the Egyptian government. Like us, for example, you got black people who ain't feeling this United States government because we know what happened to us. Not saying that the Egyptians was violent and they forced their views on people, but I'm just using this for example. Black people, you know, sometimes we call the uproar against the oppression of what racial white supremacy do within this country. And we know we're not from there, we're from Africa. So what I'm saying is that you had people in the Levant, for example, in the Battle of Megiddo, the Tutmosis III book, that he started hacking up. Because a few of those West Asians were like, fuck these Egyptians. We tired of them controlling this shit. Then you had the Battle of Kadesh. That nigga Ramesses II was fighting against those Hittites over Syria. They controlled the borders. So what I'm saying is that my argument is that Narmer did not unify Upper and Lower Egypt. He tried to unify the land to keep those ties in Asia.
Just like the enigma, like the enigma story or the folk story of Nimrod. Just when they got from the Egyptians, those Jews got from the Egyptians when they were joining those mystery schools, what they call. But that was an enigma, the tower, and everybody spoke one language. That was the enigma of the trade route of Narmer, you know what I'm saying? Of him controlling those, you know what I'm saying, their trade between Mesopotamia and Nile Valley. That the Crescent Circle is Mesopotamia and Nile Valley, really. You know what I mean?
You say what?
You go back to Egypt 5,000 years, the common Egyptians were something like African American. 70-80% Sub-Saharan African, the rest Eurasian. You go back to Egypt around 3,500 years ago, the shit was like Dominican Republic in the north, not in the south. You go back 2,000 years, the shit was like certain pockets of Puerto Rico. And if you go back to today's time, the shit is like, I don't know, it looks bad. So what I'm saying is, they've been doing that shit for a long time, bro.
And
that part
in the end, you look Mexican.
Sinjetti basically minimized the, whatever you want to call these groups of people, whether we want to call them African because I don't know how you can look back into ancient Mesopotamia and define who is who is not an African, who is African. It's impossible to do, man.
No, we listen, brother. Let me just say this now. I'm not denying an African presence in Mesopotamia because it's obvious it was there. You had E3B there, which comes out of Ethiopia, 24,000 years ago. And you had the Natufians that went over there 15,000 years ago. You had the Nubian A group who was doing trade over there. So you do have Africans there, but they're not there by themselves because they crossbred who left out of Africa 60,000 years prior before them, who developed different phenotypes and developed different spit markers within their geographical location. For example, if you look at haplogroup J carriers 30,000 years ago, they were not white.
Let me ask you this. Do you think, even if we say, okay, it's the distinctions and within the DNA groups, ethnically, right, which makes us ethnically different, do you think you're not dealing with the same type of human being you were dealing with 30,000 years ago? You know that? You're not dealing with the same type of human being you were dealing with 30 years ago. As today.
What do you mean?
30,000 years ago, you're not dealing with the same man as you're dealing with today, man. When you go back, you're dealing with, like, they were smaller. Phenotypically, they were looking more different. When you go back and look at some of these old skulls, even if you look at Lucy, and they took that back to a million-some years ago, but this is kind of like, okay, all right. You know, some people could say that's not us. Okay, cool.
She was Australopithecus. She wasn't in a homogeneous family, but she was a common thread to prepare for us. But she wasn't anatomically modern, what we call human, or as racial scientists say, modern anatomically correct. She was Australopithecus, which goes back 3.5 million years, and you have Ardipithecus, which is also.
So what you're telling the people is that we evolved from that phase to another phase, right?
Through time, it was. But again, Lucy. But Lucy was not a gorilla or a chimp. These were the preparers or preparation for the homogeneous family. The first beginning of the human being starts with Homo habilis or handyman, and then after
like
him
God
comes,
looking at
Homo
like God
Gattis
looking
God.
At himself.
And it's all humans. It's just you just have archaic humans. Archaic humans look a little bit more.
Yeah.
You know, we refer to as primitive.
So you think man is no different?
They have a short forehead. They don't have a short forehead. They have flatter head. You know,
you're right. The cranium was more flatter, but from the neck down, they look human, especially Homo erectus. You know what I'm saying? But the cranium was more flatter, and they couldn't see from the side of their face. But their face, their eyes were more closer. But you have to study the homogeneous branch of humanity, which were all humans.
Those people that left out 58,000 years ago and moved to the Middle East and various places in Asia mixed with different various species of Homo heterobagandis and Homo
right. Right, because Homo heterobagandis his black ass, which was because he was dark skinned, his ass left out of Africa around 600,000 years ago because he developed around 800,000 and he becomes Homo erectus somewhere between Iraq, but he populates the Neanderthal Valley in Germany and certain parts of Europe and become Neanderthal. And then later on, he goes into the Siberian region to become Homo Denisovan, but he leaves Africa. He was dark-skinned. He's not a dark-skinned Neanderthal. That's all Homo heterobagandis was, with slight differences by point percentages. That's it.
Yeah.
And different
variations of Homo heterobagandis as it went down, as it stayed in Africa, it formed into a Homo Rhodesian man, as you can see, you find in Zimbabwe. You know what I'm saying? From Homo Rhodesian man, you get Homo sapien adultus.
That's right.
From Homo sapien adultus, you get the anatomically modern man. That's
right.
Anatomically correct, man. But anatomically
modern. Let me ask you a question. The ones you just named, the different phases, the different evolutions of man. Do you know if one of those phases of man saw you today, he probably wouldn't even know what you was or who you were or wouldn't even recognize you, and he could say, well, you're not me or you're not from, you know what I'm saying, you're not me.
Well,
I don't accept you because that's what
I bet you'll make love to your woman.
He probably will. But what I'm saying is I made that point to say because of migration. We're saying because the migration took place at a certain point in time between a tribe, right? That they're no longer my brother no more. That tribe over there is no longer my brother. And secondly, what I'm arguing is that culturally you can retain that group that migrated still can retain the original universal principles.
What you got to understand, black people do it today. You know, you see it in gangs, you see it in like Vice Lords and Disciples and GDs, or Crips and Bloods. I mean, they all come from common threads, but in certain areas, they get along. In certain areas, you can't wear certain colors or do certain things without getting black. So what I'm saying is that...
But the Bloods and Crips still retain the law. They still retain the core values and the law.
In certain pockets. But for example, I'm from in Chicago. Vice Lord and Disciples ain't got no common thread. I mean, the folks draw with love, life, loyalty, knowledge, wisdom, understanding. Again, the brothers under this demonstration of Finballers, love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. Either way, they don't have a common thread at all. But they do have a common language. The situation and the struggle with anything. But they don't have an idea, just like the black power movement organization, and they spread out.
You know what I'm saying?
But that's what the Israelites are saying. I don't know if y'all really listening, but it's what the Bible is saying is that whoever these people were, they were there. And they were able to retain these core universal principles.
But the Israelites have more in common with people from Mesopotamia than they do to Egypt. That's what I'm trying to tell you. The Garden of Eden to them was not in Africa. Some people can Africanize it, but it was actually in between an island Iraq. They talk about those different rivers, but those people have a lot in common with the people in southern Iraq, which was the Chaldees. And at this time, mythical Abraham, 2000 BC or 1800 BC, this shit was being ransacked by Gutians, who are modern day Kurds, and also the Harians was just leaving from the Caucasus. So what I'm trying to tell you is that their origin starts in Mesopotamia. They just steal shit from the Nile because Abraham leave out of Egypt as a wealthy man, but he go to dirt poor, like most West Asians do. You know, they learn a blueprint, they learn a game. Once they learn a game, they go back out and they do their thing.
But now, hold on, because when you say Abraham, what I hear is this person from the East came into Egypt as most Easterners did at different occasions. That's what I hear. And what you would have to establish is that they didn't already have the same types of system already going on in Mesopotamia. You can't argue that according to the myth
of Abraham, mythically speaking.
Forget the myth. Hold on, let me just say this.
According to the literature, Abraham went to Egypt around what? 1800 BC, right?
No, that's not true.
I'm saying according to the myth, he went to Egypt at what time period? 2000 BC or 1800 BC, right?
I mean, just make your point.
So he went there around 1800 BC. Now here's the trick with this 1800 BC period. At this time, Africans wasn't even controlling the northern part of Egypt that he went to. It was controlled by the Hyksos, foreign ruler.
Right.
But wait a minute, you're conjecturing
with the story. First of all, you're saying he's a myth.
So how you gonna make an argument set in stone? You know what the myth is? No, I know what you're saying.
I know what you're saying, but the greater point that you're making is that an Asiatic came into Egypt like they typically did and came in, okay, finish making your point.
Okay, what I'm trying to say now, the reason why I say mythical is I'm a non-believer. You're a believer. I'm talking about...
I understand that because I know that the Egyptians talked about Abraham, so I can come right back with a source to show you that he really did exist.
I don't agree with it. I think that's some stuff that they put in there and made up. That's bull crap. What I'm saying is, mythically speaking, though... Abraham went into that area around 1800 BC. you know, which is 3,800 years ago. During this time, foreign rulers controlled Egypt. So it makes sense that they were openly opening up the borders for more Euro agents, because when the Hyksos took over, the only person they had up there ruling was Nehesi, and Nehesi's father was an Asiatic. His mother was black. We got the parents' names now. So you were right about this. He was partially Nubian, but his daddy was an Asiatic. So this nigga was one of those Haile Selassie-looking cats up there. That's what I'm trying to say. So what I'm trying to say is this, brother. Go ahead, brother. Go ahead.
No, what I was going to say is this, man. You see at least by 3300 BCE, but you know it had to be established before then if you had as many countries taking part. You had from the Mediterranean Sea all the way going down near to China, at least to Iran and India and those major areas. You had a universal trade network going on with one language and one currency going on. You might be able to, cuneiform. But I'm saying, do you know what it takes to get everybody on the same page to say, okay, this is the system we for the come up with. This is how we're gonna put it to work and everything like that. So to say that Abraham, by the time he came into Egypt, was ignorant of let's say this, not even Abraham. Let's say an Asiatic that came out of that system coming into Kemet, he already understood a system was at play. But by the time they
Let's go back to linear graph. Semitic gets his dialect from proto-Sinetic. So, of course, the people that live on
is going to be
Semitic language. Proto-Sinetic is Egyptian writing script. I'm just saying. Well, the proto-Sinetic writing script from the Hermetic Medunetta goes back, I think, 5,300 years ago when they got their writing language. I'm not saying that all of Semitic. Listen. I'm not saying that all of Semitic get it from them. It's like what Sanjeti was saying earlier when we talked about Cushitic, or what we refer to as East African and Medu or Egyptian speaking languages that crossbreed with Indo-European language. They got some stratum from proto-Sinetic. So I'm trying to say some stratum, not all. Let me finish, brother. Semitic languages, like let's talk about the cuneiform. That was a trade universal language between certain parts of the Nile, because you can see it in our minor letters. They got the cuneiform writing back and forth to not. But of course, it was a universal language because they had to create a certain dialogue to network with each other. This is like with Bantu language.
But this shows you which system is older.
Listen, you're cutting me off, bro. It's just like with Bantu language that developed around 6,000 years ago in Niger Congo. Those brothers only created their language through trade with each other amongst one another. Bantu means people. It's a people dialect for trade, only for people in that forest. So if the Egyptians or these Africans had to be trade with the people in West Asia, of course they spoke a certain dialect to trade amongst one another.
This is before the dynastic period, bro.
Let's talk about the Harappa civilization in India. You talked about the Indians. The Harappians, they dealt with cuneiform with the people in Iraq and Iran through Pakistan. But they had their own language. They spoke Tamil. They didn't even speak Hindi yet. They spoke Tamil dialect. So they did have trade languages amongst each other that they used to network. You're correct.
What does that say about this area? Because you're making it seem as if that people when they came into Egypt that they was ignorant. When they were, that's like me going from America and going down to Russia, and me not knowing about accounting and government and politics.
I'm not saying they're ignorant. I'm just saying at that time Egypt was hot. It was the place to be.
Let's get it correct. But at that time, at 3300 BCE and probably up to 4000, Sumeria was hot. Mesopotamia was hot.
Listen, bro. Kemet and Sumeria were rival empires. So you can't even say who was.
No. I misspoke when I said Sumeria. I said Mesopotamia.
Both of these cultures evolved. They writing out of proto writing, which started out of the hunter gatherers in Tanzania with the Shango bone.
So what you're saying is that all these groups was in Tanzania. So you're saying that, when you say stuff like they develop.